Peace, y'all. Before we get started, I felt compelled to remind everyone to stay safe and stay abreast of all the atrocities happening around the world. The people of Palestine, Tigray, Congo, Sudan, Haiti, and countless other territories are currently fighting for their rights and their lives. And if you're choosing to take action, please take every precaution you can. Stay hydrated, stay in groups, cover your face, and please, more than anything, don't lose hope. I've been leaving links to organizations and resources at the bottom of every episode description for a good minute, so please go check those out for places to donate and to find ways to take action today. We're not free until all oppressed people in the States and abroad are free. Much love, stay strong, and stay dangerous. What's good, y'all? My name is Dylan Green, and this is Real Notes, a space dedicated to blurring the cultural and artistic lines between rap and film. I'm here to chop it up with everyone from rappers and producers to journalists and video directors about their relationship to movies and how, if at all, film inspires their craft. My guests this week are Connecticut-via-New York rapper-producer Polo Perks, Atlanta producer-rapper Feardorian, and Milwaukee rapper AyooLii. We spoke about their recent show at Substance Skatepark in Brooklyn, movies like Elephant, WALL-E, New Jack City, Don't Be a Menace to South Central, several Disney Channel original movies, the power of knowing the history of your influences, how they came together as a trio, blending lowend and drill, and the creative process, and plenty of stories behind their latest project, The Dog's Chance. Come fuck with us. What's cracking, everybody? Welcome back to the hottest episode of Real Notes on fucking record right now. reporting live from the heat wave, Dylan Green, CineMasai, got a lot of names, do a lot of shit, outside, inside, all sides. I saw a pair of vapes.
Oh my god, that's so crazy. I saw a pair of vapes. I got my papers in the side pocket.
I saw a pair of vapes melt into the sidewalk on Union Avenue in Brooklyn yesterday. It's fucking hot as hell. It's been like 95 degrees every day. Nah, bro, you're good. Fucking, we're here.
That's pretty gross.
Yo, I can hear you like that mic is on. That's wild. All right.
It's on. Yeah. It's on. I'm trying to tell you
the
mic is on.
Nah,
I keep trying to tell you, I was like, because you was like, is it on? Nah, it's not on. I'm like, yeah. Hey, talk.
This shit is so, because only two things are showing up on the wave. It's fucking me up.
Like, yeah, it's the pirate glitch.
I trust you. Because you always know what you're talking about. So for people who don't know, I don't got two people. I got three people in here today. I think this is the first three person roundtable Real Notes ever. So, my brother's here, broke a record. I'm really happy to have him here.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Yeah, you already know, man. Yeah. Like, I can't even Polo Perks, Feardorian, AyooLii. Like, yo, man, thank y'all so much for being here.
Legendary day.
Man, yeah, like, the best, you know? But first and foremost, been a fan of all three of y'all for, like, a hot-ass minute. To see y'all come together to do a project, amazing. B, like, all the separate shit. We're going to get into a little bit of that later. But, like, just thank y'all for taking the time. I know it's busy. And, like, I don't know. It just means a lot when people come and fuck with me. So,
thanks for having us.
Yeah, no, you already know. Before we get into the first questions and shit, I want to talk about this show that just happened. I want to talk about what happened to Substance. So how did it come together? How did y'all, I mean, like, y'all have been linked up with Nobels forever, but, like, mm-hmm. How did this happen, and how did y'all enjoy it? Because that shit was stupid. Like,
I feel like it's kind of crazy, because, like, I know, like, Nobels was, like, the lineup is so crazy, because, like, I know for a long period of time, like, Nobels wanted to reach out to Critter, you know, like, they had a lineup that they wanted it to be me, Baby Osama, and I forgot who the other artist was, but it, like, you know, they couldn't, like, get everything lined up together.
Yeah.
So, at the time, like, I know, like, we was already working on the album, already pushing the album, and between Nobels and, like, my manager, you know, G, like, mm-hmm. everyone at the EQ family was just like, let's just try to just, instead of making it, like, this whole big thing, let's just keep it simple, like, and base it on, like, you know, the people that know how to tune the energy in the city. Like, you know what I mean? Due to my track record, you can already see how Dorian's show is looking on his track record right
now.
Lee's show is looking crazy on his track record. So once they, like, kind of switched it over to that, I feel like it was just more in our corner to, like, have or do make it look however we wanted it to. And, like, I've been cool with Substance for, like I said, like, a good 4 years right now. That's, like, my people. Shout out to Andrew from Substance. He, like, never, ever, ever, not once. He knows what I do for, like, the kids. He knows what I'm doing for the community. Like, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's why we do a free show at Substance, you know what I'm saying? Because it's, like, that's a space, a safe space for the kids, you know, at all ages, no matter what, regardless. But, you know, it's just, it's always good to know that I have Andrew in my corner, or no matter what, you know what I'm saying? I have somebody who trusts me with their space enough. Like, no, I don't even think y'all seen Andrew that night. He just upped and left. So it's like, you know.
I think the timing was also really good. It being Go Skate Day, it was like, it landed perfectly with the album and like it being at Substance. It was super cool.
And honestly, the people that was on, like, the people that's, as you see the sponsors, those are everybody that's been in the corner for the past, like, you know, since getting this ball rolling.
Right.
You know, so as far as Nobels and, you know, shout out to the homies Frozen, shout out to Line Leap for, you know, also helping us out too as well. Who else we had on that flyer? Substance, Run Along, Nobels. Like, Nobels has been like it's just like everybody that's on that flyer is a genuine connection. It should have only happened that way.
Right, always. And yeah, like I could just tell just based off like the way niggas was in that pit, like, you know, like just like I was like in the center of it for a handful of songs, and just like I can't remember the last time I was in a pit, period, but just like it just felt good. You know, like,
I turned around and looked like that because I've been saying, like, you know, we're going to touch it. I'll like probably have to like run through this shit again. But it's like it's been so much going on out here, bro. And then music in general. Right.
Yeah.
Where there's a big there's a big group, a big audience of people that no one's making music for today. It just stopped. At one point, it was like the most accessible, tangible thing that we can get, like, oh, and at any point we just looked over it, and then now you look up, it's like, oh, like, no one's making that sound of music, no one's catering to that audience,
right.
No one's catering to just, like, you know, just your everyday average, like, and it's just, like, that, those people matter a lot, like, you feel me, like,
yeah.
It's like, we don't always have to make something a gimmick or, like, a sound or, like, a train,
right.
You know what I mean, and even in this situation, it's like, I feel like it will also work good, because you got artists like AyooLii, who's from Milwaukee, artists like me, who's Black, but also use rock stuff and had to make it seem like it's not a trend or a gimmick, you know what I'm saying? And then you got the sound that's being used and stolen from every which fucking way impossible from his fucking city
right
now.
Yeah.
And no one's giving it credit, and it's like no one's taking it serious, and now we dropped this project and everyone's taking it dead fucking serious, and that's what matters, like.
Mm-hmm. Like more than anything, like Milwaukee's been going crazy these last couple of years, like particularly last year, like seeing, like Lee, you've been so prolific, like I can't keep up with the amount of music you drop.
Everything you do is outstanding. Like,
yeah, you drop hella shit, bro. Like, that's what that means, you know. Like,
you're very consistent. You're one of the most consistent people I know with music.
Yeah, nah, like,
appreciate it, man.
Yeah, nah, you already know. Like, and just because I'm curious, you know, like, what do you feel you bring to the Milwaukee scene that nobody else does? Like, what's the most AyooLii thing you bring to what you do?
Shit, I just be being myself, really. And hopefully motherfuckers go off that energy. But, like, even what Polo was saying, like, you know how you do the rock star shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the Milwaukee people don't really, like, how the tape was, motherfuckers don't really fuck with the tape like that until it's like one song that goes viral. Or,
yeah,
you know, it takes
something like that
for a motherfucker. But it's like, just for me to be doing this, like what I'm doing right now, it's like, oh yeah, this, I'm on something completely different than what they on type shit.
Yeah.
And I just bring like, you know, everybody be too serious and shit. I be bringing a little joy in.
Mm-hmm.
You still have fun.
Right.
And you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, nah, like, hitting your phone like a bill collector, like, that's, like, yo, fun, you know? Like,
that's so crazy, because on the way here, I'm listening to the album, and I'm just thinking, like, that's such a crazy opening bar, like, you just, like, you bring a lot of comedic relief. People do be too dead serious.
Witty.
Bro. Like,
yeah.
Witty rapper.
It's very, like, fun bars. Like, and it's very fun music.
My personality matches the music.
Right.
Yeah. It's like if the Anchorman was only through a soundtrack and not, like, you feel me? Yeah, we get to see a character, but it's, like, also in your music. You able to, your actions that you show off, you're able to do that with your vocals, too. I think, like, that's, like, the most important thing about, like, working with Lee is that, like, you can get more than one character sound approach on a verse, approach on a hook, or anything like that. Like, he, like, and even with this tape being under his belt, he really is the most versatile artist coming out of that city. Mm-hmm. Like, and that's the craziest thing about it is because, like, since he's not out here making his career a gimmick or, like, shit like that, niggas just try to sit there and be like, But if you think about it, bro, like, he done sat here and brought us funk.
Yeah.
He done sat here and did a whole rock album, country song, country samples, like, all types of shit. We even got a Drain sample out of this kid, bro. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, this really is the most versatile artist, and I'm glad that we got this tape out, because it's like, to the people who really do care about music and do care about hard work and do care about whether a project is really based off fun and natural and not, like, going and booth and sound like the last 10 niggas.
Right.
Like,
that shit's
too important. Like, especially, you know, like, considering, like, Lee, again, you know, like, I know you just, like, there's, like, a lot of trapper, like, a lot of certified trapper in there, a lot of Rock Wave in there, like, Doo-Wop Kane, like, you've mentioned all these people as, like, influences on you, but, like, you don't sound like any of them. You know, like, that's, like, that's the, like, oh, that's the cool part, because it's real. I mean, like, we're all our influences. Like, every single person here is here because they heard somebody else do some shit, and it was like, I want to do that. But the three of y'all don't sound like the people that you are influenced by, even though, like, I can tell, like, you can see the building blocks, but it's not like, you know, like, it's not like you're just doing, like, karaoke, you know, like, y'all are on your own shit, and I never... You know, like, even though, like, I know, like, you and Dorian already had a pretty strong relationship at that point, but, like, I never expected to see the three of y'all come together and do a whole album. So, like, it's been cool to really sit with it and, like, just, like, show people, like, this is that.
Yeah.
But I want to before we get more into the project, I want to ask y'all the first question, or I guess it's usually the first question I ask everybody who comes here, but this is my so it would be, what was the last movie or TV show y'all watched that you had a strong opinion about?
Movie or TV show I watched that I had a strong opinion about. I think the last movie that mattered, because I don't have strong opinion on movie because I know it's a goddamn movie. But the last movie that mattered to me that set at least like a stamp, like,
yeah,
as far, was probably The Elephant. Yeah, for sure, The Elephant. I don't watch TV shows. I watch South Park and Robot Chicken every night to go to sleep. But, like, The Elephant was definitely a fire-ass movie that I was, like, this was played, like, it's, I don't know, have you ever seen it?
Never. I've never even heard of it.
It's, like, so pretty much it's about, like, a school shooting type shit, but it's, like...
Oh, this is Elephant. Yeah, yeah.
Elephant.
I know what this is. I know what this is.
The way they plotted that shit out.
Yeah.
That nigga needs to be getting paid to this very moment.
Started,
the way they plotted that shit out.
Yeah.
Like, they need, because, like, I think
that movie's wild.
When it comes to topics like that, you know what I'm saying? I think there couldn't have been never a better way to put it through, because it shows how much everyone is affected, not just from a one-person point of view. So that really definitely influenced me. Even, like, visually with the shit that I want to do, like, I plan and intend to hopefully put out something that's like that as well. Like, that shit is, like, really, really, really a fire ass movie.
Right. Yeah. So you said The Elephant, and, like,
My bad.
No, you're good. It's no problem. Like, but like, you were talking about it, and then this was from 2003. Gus Van Sant made this shit. Like, I was, I used to be on Apple Movie Trailers back in the day, and I would, like, watch all the trailers for upcoming movies, and I saw the poster, and it's just, like, this small picture.
It looks,
like,
nothing of what the, like, fuck you're about to get hit
zero,
with.
Zero, bro.
Yeah, because I'm saying, what is it about?
I was,
I want to watch.
It's about the
Columbine shooting.
Yeah.
Oh.
But it's from a point of view from each person. So it's like, it starts with this kid who wakes up in his crib, right? And then he goes to the bathroom. As he goes to the bathroom, whatever the fuck, his sister walks past him. Now the camera follows his sister, and you're in her life for a little bit.
Yeah.
And then, like, as she walks back out and goes downstairs to the kick, like, it's like everything is connected. Even when they go to school, like, the people that's in the principal office is also connected because everybody's affected by this one thing.
They, I think they also show, like, how normal the day seemed.
So normal. And, like, right at the end of the movie, like, the kid is like, fuck, I forgot something at home. And he's walking out of school. And then the two kids are walking in with guns. Yeah. And he's like, what are you doing? And like, at one point, he's, like, trying to, like actually, like, he's concerned. Like, what are y'all doing? He's like, you don't want to even be here. Leave. And he leaves. And, like, it goes on to show what happens. It's like an hour of normalcy, and then the last 10 minutes is just...
Yeah, all hell breaks loose, bro. It's insane.
It's like a whole hour of just watching straight niggas normal life, and then...
And then the end is just catastrophic.
Yeah.
I was talking to this girl, and she was like, yo, let's like watch some movies. She put on Elephant, bro, and I was like, yo, like, why would you put this on? Like, bro, because I'm thinking, we're watching it, I don't know the plot, I don't know the premise or anything, so we're just watching it. Then it gets to the end, I'm like, yo, why would you put this on? Like, this isn't romantic or, like, anything like, at all.
That's why you just me put your arm over it.
No, I'm like, why do you have to watch this, like, out of all movies?
The Netflix pops up, are you still watching?
Not, bro, like,
bro,
like
the girl just did that with me with that show Baby Reindeer.
Oh my god, son.
Bro.
What's Baby Reindeer?
My lady just watched all of Baby Reindeer. I haven't seen none of it. I wasn't home.
That's
but,
shit
too much.
Really. Shorty was yo, bro, like, it's crazy because Lee, like, you know, usually, like, today and day and time that they make so many movies that's, like, in a point of view of, like, guy creep, woman, like, being a prey.
Yeah.
But this one is, like, SWAT. And it's, like,
woman creep.
God
being a prey.
Right? I gotta watch bro, like, nigga, it's
it sounds like some juicy shit.
It's like,
nah, because you know. I'm not even gonna say that on here.
Nah.
We need movies like that. Meminist.
not even. Not even.
It's not like that.
Nah, I don't think so.
I don't know.
Is it cool if Quinn pushes up here?
What happened?
Is it cool if Quinn pushes up here?
Yeah.
All right, bet.
Yeah.
I just feel like, personally, movies are ass now. It's mostly gonna be a movie from like before 2010. It's gonna be hard.
Yeah.
But I mean,
Elephant's crazy, man. One. Like I haven't seen it in years. But like you just reminded me it existed. Now I gotta go back and watch it again. Shit.
Or you know it's like one of like one of my favorite movies, and this movie never clicks with niggas because like they were too young. But like if you was in Hollywood Video, you seen this movie like Idle Hands.
No, I never seen Idle Hands.
See, bro, it's a movie about this kid, right, who smokes this weed or whatever the fuck, and then like he passes out, but his hand becomes possessed by like a spirit of somebody else, and he wakes up, he lives a normal day. And throughout the day, he starts realizing, like, bro, where's my parents? So then, like, he has his two jack-o'-lanterns in the house. He knocks them over, and it's his parents dead, right? Then his boys walk in, and he's like, I don't know what it is. And then, like, his hand starts tweaking and grabs his man's. And he's like, that's when he starts realizing his hand is tweaking.
Right.
But he goes through the whole entire movie, cuts his hand off, mad shit, now his hand running around town, fucking doing a bunch of nut-ass shit. Like,
yeah.
It's a fire movie.
Sounds tight. Like, I had no idea where to find it, but like I'm all into that like weird fucking like all sorts of shit like that. That sounds amazing. Like, do you know where I can find it right now?
You probably can literally find it like Netflix or either like HBO. All
right, cool. Yeah, I'm finding it in that case. Dorian and Lee, what about y'all? What was the last thing y'all watched that like made an impression?
So, I guess like it was my first time watching it, but I used to have, since I just graduated recently, right. I had a journalism class, but it was really yearbook. But it was like yearbook slash journalism. So for my final project, they were like, okay, you have to pick like a Disney movie and do a film analysis on it, essentially. So I picked WALL-E because one particular summer, I was like, I had to be like maybe like 10. I was like super, super duper young. But like we didn't have like no cable or like nothing like during the summer. And, like, we just didn't have nothing to watch. So I'm watching WALL-E, like, 50 different times. So I was like, all right, I'm going to do a film analysis on WALL-E. So we watched WALL-E in class. And I had to, like, basically break down like what was I gonna say? Basically like the environmental issues with Wally, like how the city is deserted.
Right.
And they basically left it behind. They found the plant, brought it to Earth. It was just like a bunch of stuff that had to break down, but that was probably like honestly my favorite Disney movie. Wally is super good. But I also have like it's like a part of my childhood as well. So it's the last movie I watched.
Had you so I mean like you'd seen it before. Like how'd you feel watching it again for this guy? I mean like that's like in like a whole different context.
Yeah. Too. I think it's like it's a lot of details that I like actually got to witness now that like I'm older and I can like see it. Definitely like I don't know, like it's kind of mad dystopian. Like, I didn't realize how dystopian it was when I was younger because it's just like, oh, it's like a Disney movie. Let's throw it on. But, like, now I'm older. I'm actually rewatching it, like, with full consciousness. Like, I'm seeing how dystopian it is, for sure.
Yeah. And it's just, like, a little hopeful. You know, you got, like, you got, like, the tree.
Yeah.
That they have, like, the little the little plant that, like, the Eve robot has. And
Eve, like, automatically shut down when they found the plant. And then Wally's, like... Wally's like, yo, what happened? Like, she's not rocking with me no more. But not really. They were just trying to preserve the plant. It's like a crazy movie.
Yeah, it's so much. And just like them being on like the big ass spaceship and like having all the people in the chairs. Like,
Bro, it was. They made everybody like super like obese because like they're just riding around in the chair, like everything to their disposal. Like, no one's walking around anywhere. Everyone has like hoverboards. It's like a screen on the like a car they're driving. Like, it's like crazy.
I can't remember the first time I saw it, but yeah, that movie kind of like I might have been a little bit older than you are now when I first saw it, but like it was just
what year did that drop?
It must
2012, 2014.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, not something like that. Let me.
I was like, you sure? 2008.
It was like 2012, 2014.
It was 2006. No. 2008. You got it. It was 2008.
Two.
Yeah.
What the fuck? that old?
Yeah, no, that shit. That shit came out when before pre-2010.
Wow,
dog.
Yeah, no, I was in high school.
They snapped.
I always
wanted to watch. I've never watched it.
I avoided movies like that.
Like when Disney started doing like in theater like back to back films, I was like, all right, this is gonna fuck up. Fucking what is that I just one favorite movie I had on Disney but I haven't watched so long. Oh, Halloween Town.
Yeah,
I didn't want nothing to fuck up Halloween Town. And then there's this other one that was on Disney from back in the day.
Halloween Town was fire.
But it was like the real life. It was the real life like movies that Disney used to have.
Yeah. The Disney Channel originals.
Yeah, it was like one of those shits. I just can't remember what it was. Halloween Town though, definitely. I definitely was like trying to preserve that shit as much as possible. So I didn't watch too many other new Disney movies.
Nah, there were. I mean, like, there's such a crazy list of like Disney Channel original. Like, because it's not a favorite, but somebody was talking about it recently. You ever see Cadet Kelly, with Hilary Duff?
Yes. You ever seen the Cheetah Girls movies?
Of course, I've seen the Cheetah Girl movies. Yeah, nah, like
Disney's definitely had the Cheetah Girls, Lizzie McGuire, Cadet Kelly, even Stevens movie.
Yep.
Damn, there was another. Yo, what was that girl that used to... All right, she went from Missy Elliott videos dancing.
I know exactly who you're talking about. The girl who was, like, dancing on stage and like, with the squeaking sneakers and shit.
She used to be on Zach and Cody.
Yeah, bro. Yeah. What's her name? Bro?
I don't know her name,
I was trying to bring it up the other day. Like, bro, she put in twerk. Like, she really did went hard for Disney.
Yeah, honestly, like...
She was in Camp Rock, too,
I think. Yeah.
She was doing everything.
Yeah, no, they were...
She came from Missy Elliott videos.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. She's in the Work It video, right? I'm pretty sure. Yeah.
She's in like three of them shit.
Yeah. the first time I remember seeing her was in
the Work It shit.
She might have been in the Lose Control video. Yes, I can't remember.
It was all three. Lose Control, Work It. Damn.
Yo.
Good time.
Crazy shit, man. Before we move on, Lee, what was the last thing you watched that you felt like strongly about?
You had to be Black Mirror. You seen the Black Mirror shit, right?
Yeah. Not all of it, but which one are you talking about?
Shit.
Just all of them?
No, not all of them. It'd be some. Like, I just like the concept of what the fuck they be doing in there. Like, you know, the little especially when it be the futuristic shit, like, I'll be wondering, like, how the fuck everything gonna be in, like, you know, 50 years and shit, you know? This shit different right now. This shit was in here. So it's like when they be doing all that, there's just one where it was a dating. I guess it would tell people, like, how long their relationship is. Everything all off the years.
I know what you're talking about.
Nigga, AI could do that shit damn near. Who knows?
Right.
You ever seen that episode where it's, like, people rate every interaction they have with you?
Yes.
Yeah.
And you got rated, and then you lose your job.
It's like everyone looks at you crazy. Right. You gotta have a 5-star rating to, like, interact with people and stuff. Like, it's kind of crazy.
Right.
They didn't let her on an airplane because her rating was too low.
Remember, she got... what was she trying to do? Go to a wedding?
A wedding or something, yeah. And they were like, well, you need to have this certain amount of stars to get on this plane. Yeah. And she was like, oh, but, like... She starts arguing with the clerk, and that brings her down even more points.
Yeah, right. Yeah, no, they don't play about that shit. Mine was there was one where they made this like interactive horror game that was like a VR type shit.
That's the one I like too. Where they put the shit in his head.
Uh huh. And then like it ends with him like he dies because he's like in the middle of like a thing with, like all I remember is him like screaming about his mom and then like his brain just shorts and he's just dead. Like I called my mom after that shit. Like I'm so serious. Bro, like I was like, mom, I love you. Like
that's how he's like, traumatizing, bro.
That shit really had me fucked up.
Mm-hmm.
But
that shit was scary too. The shit would just come out of nowhere. And he's in his whole fucking house and shit. He thinking it's a video game, really shit hitting him and shit.
Yeah, man. Nah. Like the best episodes of Black Mirror really had me thinking. Like the one, like my absolute favorite one is probably San Junipero. You ever see San Junipero?
You gotta explain it.
So like it's like another virtual reality one, but it's about these two women who fall in love in like this simulation. But you
don't. No. No, you talk about where it was two dudes. They put the
No.
Oh, okay.
That's Striking Vipers. Striking Vipers is a good one too, but like the other. But no, this is
two dudes.
Yeah.
They put it on.
That one is crazy.
And then they get to fucking in the game.
Yeah, Striking Vipers is a crazy one. But yeah, like yeah, but yeah, not Black Mirror. Black Mirror is super cool. Let's run it. Let's run it all the way back with the three of y'all. What's the first movie experiences y'all could ever remember having? Like, it could be at the theater. It could be at your cousin's house. Like, the first experience that comes to mind.
What'd you say?
Y'all can go first.
All right. So my first movie experience, I'll say, like, just when I just remember a movie or something.
Yeah. Yeah, just like
I'm thinking hard.
Yeah,
like first one that comes to mind. It doesn't.
Okay,
it doesn't.
Don't be in Menace, South Central.
That's a good choice. That's a great
choice. I just remember one. Freaking New Jack City, bro.
Ooh-wee. Wow. All right. So let's start with South Central. Tell me about like watching it. Like what?
Like I remember that was the first movie that really like got me wanted to do comedy. You know what I'm saying? Cause it was so funny to me.
Yeah.
Like, that's like one of the only movies I could watch over and over and over again.
Right.
But it's like, I don't know, the shit was just so funny, but it was all trying to be serious. I guess it was a parody off of, you know,
Right, yeah, because, like, the thing I always loved is, like, the title, that, like, for anybody who doesn't know, it's like,
it's
Don't Be a Menace.
Title, but just... while drinking juice in the hood.
Right, yeah. Don't be a menace to South Central while drinking your juice in the hood. And, like, the whole thing, like, the whole title encompasses, like, a bunch of, like, 90s hood movies. You got, like, of course, like, you got like, Menace to Society, Juice, South
Boys
Central,
in
Boys in the Hood.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know? So, like, that was definitely one of my first experiences, like, I'd seen the movies before that, but to, like, see somebody bring them
all together.
Like, in that way. It was like, that and, like, it was that and like the Scary Movie movies, to be honest.
Yes.
You know, like, cause
I love
like
the Scary
same,
movie.
Same family though.
Right?
Same
yeah. No, it's all the Wayans type shit. But yeah.
Same
so, Dorian, talk to me about New Jack City.
Bro, honestly, okay.
Oh, wait.
The
fact that you brought that movie up, I just want to say, you are not one. You're not the same as the rest of these kids,
bro. Like, nah, cause like I mean, it's obviously been probably more than a decade since I've seen that movie. So like, but like I remember one. I feel like this is a scene everybody remembers, but, like, the building.
Yeah.
Like
I'm about to bust your head. I'm about to bust your head. Can
What's
you
up?
You know who building that is?
Whose building is that?
It's Almost Hated.
What?
Carter is, like,
literally...
the Carter is literally, like, an actual, like, well-renowned, like, housing complex now. Like, you can only live there if you're up. It's dog shit, yeah.
That's crazy. The world's too small, bro.
Wow.
No, I remember, like, I remember seeing that scene, and I was like, wow, like, movies are really tragic. Like, that had me messed up for, like, a couple days. Like, I'm, like, I guarantee I definitely had, like, nightmares about it. Because I was like, yo, like, that was crazy. But I think I found that movie out for my mom. If it wasn't, like, New Jack City, definitely, like, Kill Bill. Mm-hmm. Like, my sisters, like, love Kill Bill, so, like, watching, like, that, like, trilogy. Because it was, like, multiple movies.
Yeah. It was two, I think.
Mm-hmm. So, like, I remember watching that, and, like, what situation was she in? She had to, like, wiggle her big toe, like.
Oh, yeah, when she was in the car, yeah, and, like, she was in the hospital and shit, like, yeah.
This movie is crazy. You remember, like, all the advertisements they were doing for it? Like, they were snapping.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably, like, one of my earliest memories with movies.
Yeah, fucking, I know Tarantino didn't like to use, like, real-world, like, yeah, products in his movies, mm-hmm, so he, like, made up his own product. I'm cool, bro, thank you. Mm-hmm. He made up his own products. Like, I think, like, Red Apple cigarettes was, like, a thing he created.
Oh, like, in the movie, like, when we were buying stuff, the other, like, things he made.
Yeah, the shit was always tight. Like, yeah, I feel like it was either that or, like, it was either that or Pulp Fiction might have been the first two.
Pulp Fiction too. That's,
yeah,
a good,
like,
crazy movie.
Tarantino throws a bunch of people into, like, their first, like, movie experience, yeah, like, first, like, movie experience. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I get it.
No, yeah, it was very real for me at my young age. I was like, wow, this is so serious.
You don't smoke.
I was giving it to him so he could pass it.
What was that? I think it was a Quentin Tarantino movie. It's like a old dude and it's like a car.
Nigga, Gran Torino. That bitch hard as hell. I just put my girl into the movie the other day, nigga. That movie is hard as fuck.
That movie is crazy.
Because that's the one with Clint Eastwood, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That movie's nuts.
I feel like it's been a while. My first memory of a movie. My first memory. You said, what is it? The first one.
Yeah, like first movie memory you had.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit in George of the Jungle?
Hey.
The real life version from back in the day.
George of the Jungle?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, nah, for real. Wait, hold on.
Yeah.
Because I remember that shit.
Nah, for real. When he put on the up-tempo.
Yeah.
When he put on the up-tempo, it got low. Yeah.
My baby.
Yo. Yeah.
Those two is my first memory. And that's only because my mom was a big Who Framed Roger Rabbit fan.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, for some odd reason, I ended up at the movies. Oh, it's like the South Park movie had dropped at the time.
Yep.
And my mom was like mad that my dad brought me there, so she ended up afterwards bringing me to George's Jungle.
The same day.
Yeah. Same
crazy.
Day. Y'all ever seen that movie? I think it's called Animal or some shit.
Like the one with Rob Schneider in it.
I don't know his name.
Is it the one where he, like, acts like an animal because he's got, like, animal parts in him or something? Or maybe I'm thinking of something else.
I don't remember.
Else.
I just know I was young as
fuck. Okay.
Just coming to...
The animals talking? Dr. Doolittle, maybe?
Oh, no.
Norbit?
Norbit? It's crazy.
Norbit's wild.
That's crazy.
The most late 2000s shit ever.
That's another, like, super.
Okay, yeah. You were saying it right. This one.
Yeah, that's...
this movie right here.
Bro, my sister was telling me that Norbit is a bad word. Like, we'd watch the movie, and, like, she's, like, 9 years older than me. So she's, like, trolling me. She's like, Norbit's a bad word. You can't say it.
That literally is, like, basically, like, her, like, call you fat.
Nah, yeah.
Because your sister's, so me and your sister's probably around the same age. Like, when niggas called me Norbit growing up, they was calling me fat. Like, Norbit, Respucia, Precious. Like, I was called all the hefty names in the acting Jesus. Community.
I was getting called African booty scratches.
Yeah, on some boys in the hood shit. Jeez. Yo, so, like, as y'all start to get older and have more, like, life experience and start building your own taste, like, what was the movie that, like, was there a movie that kind of made you fall in love with, or maybe not even fall in love with movies, but something that, like, really stopped you on some, like, this is more than just, like, a piece of entertainment, like, something in, like, a emotional, spiritual you know, like just like a capital M movie is what I like to call it. Mm-hmm. Like one of them, one of those, the first one of those.
The Wackness, The Wackness, Adventureland, Juno, 500 Days of Summer.
Wow, that's a crazy four.
Yeah. Nah, yeah, you went crazy. No, no.
Yeah, the what? Yeah. The Wackness.
A lot of niggas don't know about the Wackness.
The Wackness is crazy.
The Wackness is like Josh Peck, like as a New York kid, summertime selling weed out his icy cart, falls in love with this girl that so happens to be his psychiatrist's daughter.
Yeah, it's one of the Olsen girls too.
Yeah,
one of the Olsen twins. I think it's Ashley.
No.
Oh no, my fault.
It's the other girl.
Yeah, it's so, the girl from Juno. Yeah. My fault.
So then he gets all bent out in his feelings and shit. But like his psychiatrist is trying to give him advice because he knows his daughter's cheating. Like he knows his daughter's seeing another person.
Yeah.
So like, he's like trying to give him advice and shit like that. But he's not trying to like make it seem like he like even knows that his daughter's talking to him. It just turns out bad.
Dang.
Yeah, it was like at the point when like the indie movie as we know it today was kind of starting to like be solidified, and it was very much that like white dudes in like Queens listening to like Tribe Called Quest and Will Smith's Summertime and shit like that. Pop type of vibe.
Weed off Jamaican drug dealer Method
Man. Jamaican drug dealer Method Man is crazy because every time he does a Jamaican accent, it's horrible. So bad. Like I don't even know why they let him do it still, low key.
No, but, Method Man, bro, always a fucking criminal.
Or yeah, he's amazing at what he does, man. Yeah. Yo, my fault. Sorry to interrupt, but I just wanted to shout out the all new Real Notes Patreon page real quick. If you're looking for ways to connect and directly support the podcast, the Real Notes Patreon is the best way to do so. For as little as $5 a month, you can gain early, day-before access to every forthcoming episode of Real Notes, as well as an invite to the Real Notes Discord server, where you can talk to others about the latest and greatest in movies and music, come through for some listening sessions, and talk about whatever else is on your mind. I know I'm gonna be talking a bunch. If you feel like coming up off a little bit more, you could get cool exclusive content, like audio from Real Notes Live and Real Talk interviews. Those will be exclusive to patrons and ticket holders moving forward. Access to retro versions of my 60-second Minute Maid movie reviews, and even a monthly writing and podcasting workshop hosted by me. Regular episodes will still be available on a weekly basis anywhere you get your podcasts, but if you want the extras, you gotta come out them pockets a bit. Check us out at patreon.com/realnotes. That's R-E-E-L-N-O-T-E-S. I appreciate your consideration and support more than you know. Now let's get back to talking. Really crossed over in a way I never saw coming, so always shout out to Method Man. But what about y'all, like as you got older, was there something that really connected with you in like a
Perks of Being a Wallflower is really good. I like Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. That movie was crazy.
Classic,
of
course, yeah,
classic one. What's another one? Shutter Island was super crazy.
Shutter Island is wild.
Like my sister showed me that movie one day, and I literally like had a panic attack after because like, the plot twist was like so crazy. I was like, hey yo, those three for sure just like made me like be like, wow, like the film industry is like crazy, like it's just like insane, like the concepts that people even come up with, like present in a movie, it's just insane. I definitely say those three for sure.
Like Shutter Island in particular.
That one is nuts. That's probably like one of my favorite movies like ever. Probably like top three to me.
Man, I saw it in the theater when it happened, and just like walking out and just realizing that like Sun just got like lobotomized. Just
bro,
really...
nah, literally like all of it was fake. They're like, that movie is crazy.
I just watched it for the first time last month.
What happened?
I just watched that movie for the first time last week.
Oh, crazy. Yeah, nah, it's
the whole shit is fake.
It's a wild one.
Like, bro, like, he's like, no, like, this shit is real. And they're like, nah. Like,
but see, there's another movie that's like that, bro, that's real recent. And it's about this guy who, like, he's with his daughter and his dog, and his daughter falls into, like, a construction pit.
Yeah.
And he thinks, like, his daughter's just, like, sick or something. He brings her to the hospital, and, like, afterwards, like, they're like, your daughter's not here. And he said, what? Like, he tweaks out, nigga. He thinks his daughter's there, but he's mental. He don't want mental in his brain.
Right.
And kidnaps a whole nother patient.
What?
I feel like I know.
It's called, like, Wrecked or, like, something like that. It's, like, Wrecked or some shit. But it's a real fucked up movie.
Yeah, sounds like it. You know, but, like, that stuff, like, don't know. I feel like around like mid to late high school age is when I first started like really tapping in with that type of shit, and like, you know, like digging into like Criterion Collection movies that are all like weird and gory and fucked up. Right. Like, I don't know, like that type of, it's like, I feel like most people have like one period of time in their life where it's just like, you know, like you just like dive into like six of those and then either never do it again or, you know, it just takes over your life.
That is true.
You know?
But I'm approaching that time in my life. I need to consume more media. It's time. I'm ready.
Yeah, nah. I've been telling, so that's my like on site, on go. It's my brother also as well, but that's everybody. That's my boy PG. He shot like Allendale Drive, Snow Patrol, and everything like that. So like, I was just telling him like, we need to like book a weekend away from everybody and just watch straight movies and music videos to like refresh our brains on all of the shit that like we need to be doing. Like, you know?
Right.
End of the day, like you said, everything that we want to do, somebody's already done. We just gotta educate ourselves.
It's just nice to have like, you know, like not even on like any mood board shit, but just like to have, I don't know, like.
Nah, we are the king of pulling references.
Of course, like all three of y'all, like it makes perfect sense to me.
Like, even visually, like this guy right here, like he does a lot of the treatments. This is my boy Jadeja. He does a lot of music video treatments and shit like that. So like. His brain, my brain, PG brain, we all are able to like movie references and stuff like that, because that's like the your age is and my age and kind of Lee's age, and that's why I was surprised when he said New Jack City. Like, yeah. We're in the age of film,
right?
Like, you know what I mean? Like, where you buy a ticket and you go to see a movie, it's cheap on Tuesdays, cheap on Thursdays.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, if somebody buys one ticket to open the side door, we all in for free.
Yep.
So it's like
easy.
I definitely see it like in that situation of like. Where it's like you just have to stay on top of this. I'm glad that we're doing a podcast like this, like, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I don't know, man. Like, just like having that frame of reference really will just like make your whole shit stronger, and like and just like give you, I don't know, just like having context on everything and just like being able to point out like, oh, I know where that came from. Like, not even on some creative technical shit, but just like knowing just and just knowing. Being like, hey, like this comes from this, this comes from that. Yeah. Like, I don't know, like I'm exactly. Like that's why this podcast exists. Right. That's why I'm so grateful for like what all of y'all in this room do, because like this shit, I don't know, like this shit matters. It just makes me happy to see people who like get that this shit matters.
Yeah.
So you know, like for real. But before I forget, I didn't want to forget you, bro. Like, what was the like, did you have something that really, like, hit you? It doesn't have to be crazy or anything, but...
Movie that really hit me. Like,
Roots.
I'm sorry.
You're wild.
I've never watched that movie. I just
don't watch that movie.
Yeah. Toby. Is that right?
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one.
He was like, Polo.
Yeah, that shit was crazy, son. But no, what was your shit, bro?
I don't know. Cause you know I can't really remember shit.
It's cool if not.
Movies. That you talk about a movie that hit me?
Yeah.
Shit. Keep thinking, bro. It's all right.
It's back there somewhere, bro.
Yeah, no.
It's there. No, it's there.
All right, well then, we'll yeah, now we can move on and come back. Like, if you remember, it's all good. Sure. But like, you know, like, but like, let's do the.
God, barely watch TV, bro.
Nah, I feel it. I'm definitely more of a movie than a TV person. Like, I'm a TV person, but not like, it's like I'm like y'all, where I'll just like throw on like some old shit. Like, I'll throw on like Futurama or The Simpsons and just like.
That's me right now.
Yeah, like that's
Family Guy changed
right.
My shit. See? I love them.
Yeah, like that. Sad. Yeah, not like that type shit. But
you
like.
Fuck with Seventh Heaven growing up?
Not really. Like the show Seventh Heaven?
Yeah.
Not really.
I mean, my only reason I ask is because like sometimes you ever get the gist where you just like sing a theme song from a show. Some shit that you ain't seeing mad long.
Yeah.
That shit just used to hit. Like,
yeah,
that's
all
the reason I asked. It's like not a lot of people remember Seventh Heaven like theme song. We all know Dawson Creek though.
Right, yeah. We all know Dawson's Creek. We all know like fucking, I mean, even if you didn't watch it, like everybody knows the Friends theme song, you know, like it's just kind of there. I didn't watch Friends. Right. I wasn't the Friends person. Nah, but let's do the same thing with music. Like when did music become capital M music for all three of y'all? Like when did it go from being like a passive thing that was just kind of like, or like, was it ever a passive thing that was just in the background to becoming like, this is music? Like, you know, like not even in terms of like making it, but just in terms of like, I fuck with music, mm-hmm. you know? Whoever wants to go first.
I'll start first. So I was saying, I have an older sister. She's like 9 years older than me. And like, as I'm growing up, I'm probably like, let's say like 2012.
Yeah.
So like, at this point, I'm like 6 or 7.
He stole my
story. My sisters, yeah. She was like showing me music, like it was this album. What's that Nicki album? The Pink Print.
Yeah, the one with the thumbprint. Yeah.
Fire. I was like, whoa, like. She just starts showing me all this different type of music because she's growing up in like the Tumblr era. So
right,
she's like passing
all
the swag down to me. It's like she showed me stuff like Kenny Rebel, like Corbin. What else was she listening to? Like old Drake. We listened to like Chance the Rapper. What's that album? Acid Rain.
Yeah, Acid Rain.
I mean Acid Rap.
Acid Rap.
There is a song called Acid Rain.
That's what I thought it was.
One of the hardest songs on there too.
Crazy fucking song. So wild. Man.
That beat is crazy.
You got some producing you gotta do when we're done with this.
Wait, you said what?
You got some producing you gotta do.
Bro, not. I gotta tap back in, bro.
Yeah.
What's that SZA album that Chance was on?
Z, I think, right?
Yeah, Z. That song that they had specifically, like. Essential to me. What else?
Did you fuck with Because of the Internet?
The Childish Gambino album?
Yes. She was playing that like heavy as well.
That was a great album.
Crazy.
There is no album better sequence than that album.
Bro, snapping. Sam Smith too. Even like Karan Joyce, bro, which is crazy. Like stuff like that. Like she showed me all that and she had a Kindle. Not lit it yet. Like that song dropped around that time. It was like 2013, 2014. What was I gonna say? She had a Kindle. She gave me a Kindle.
Right.
So like, I'm in Atlanta. I'm on SoundCloud. I download SoundCloud on it. So I'm listening like to the early Yachty tapes. What's that 21 Savage album?
Which one? Savage. Savage Mode. Yeah. With Metro Boomin.
That was
yeah.
going crazy.
Loved Savage Mode.
What's that song? Something Dry.
Ocean Drive.
Yo, we used to pump that like just back to back for me and my sister, like super early memories with like that. So like it's always like even aside from my sister, my mom's just playing mad R&B in the house. Like yeah. Monica, who else? She also likes really like old like rap. So she like what's this one group she really likes?
Public Enemy.
She likes Public Enemy. So she's playing like R&B, all that. So I'm like gospel music too, you know, Sunday morning.
Right.
Put that gospel on. We used to go to like a mega church. One of the churches that like used to be on TV. We used to go to one of those. Yeah. So like if we're not at church, it's on TV while the gospel is playing, all that. So like it's just like a bunch of different things. Mostly from my sister though. I say my sister mostly put me onto the music that like I still even listen to today. So it's always been around me. And I just like was trying to figure out a way to do it myself.
Right.
And I got that opportunity like when I like was like leaving middle school basically. I was like, I'm gonna just get up and start doing music basically.
Right.
Yeah.
And we're gonna get into that, but there's two things I wanna bring up. A, Pink Print's a pretty good project. Truffle Butter is one of Nicki's best songs ever.
Is that on there?
It's on it was like a bonus track on the iTunes.
How does Truffle Butter go?
Yeah, how does it go?
It goes like do 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 do. They play it at NBA games. I can't remember how it rapped. But like it's on.
I don't want to get copyright.
No, you're good. But it's like it sounds crazy cool.
Drop.
Yeah. There's a drop. And like,
oh, that's okay,
Nicki.
Okay,
that's Nicki, bro.
I didn't know that was Nicki Minaj.
Because they play that shit. They play that shit at like so many NBA games. Mm-hmm. But like, it was a bonus. It was a bonus track on the album that was never like officially released. Yeah, yeah. But like, they play the beat at games all the time. So like, it's like, I don't know.
Crazy.
I love that song. And yeah, BTI, incredibly sequenced album. I was like leaving college when that shit came out. That was a special
like, that shit, like, it's so crazy. Stop. What sucks about it is that, like, Kendrick had dropped, like, a year before.
Yeah.
So, like, Good Kid, Mad City was in the air so much that, right, like, because of the internet, was more so, like, seen as, like, not even a dead serious project still. No matter how great of a project that shit was, I feel like the Dat Piff Kids and the hot new mixtapes and the kids, like,
yeah,
the people that took it in, but the other people, they were just like,
good. What's that app that had the gorilla on it?
Spinrilla.
Yeah. Spinrilla. I was on that heavy as well. Dom Kennedy too. I was like listening to Mad Dom Kennedy on there. What's that song from that album where it's like, all she needed was some.
That's the song with Chance on it. Yeah. Yeah. It's because of the internet. Yeah.
I was telling you, bro.
That song is crazy. That
fucking album was sequenced too fucking crazy.
Yeah, it went crazy.
I was the kid who was like reading, because like he put out like a screenplay and a movie with it too. Like,
I was just watching a video on that.
You were like crazy. Yo, like when I first started writing, like I wrote at least two pieces on. He made like a music video type thing called Clapping for the Wrong Reasons. It's got like L Varner and L Varner. Porn star lady's name. I can't remember her name, but she's in it. Fly Lo's in it. Chance is in it. Trinidad James is in it.
Mm-hmm. Yo, just really.
Yo. Yeah, like it's like the two of them rapping like in like a movie theater. It's super dope. Mm. But what about you, Polo? When did music become capital M music for you?
I always like, so my pops is like a real like big Dipset head, Rockefeller head.
Yeah.
So I was like always like coming around like listening to that shit and like DMX, Rough Riders and shit like that. What's kind of crazy is that, speaking on the topic of Disney, it's like you don't really know like that music is like reachable.
Yeah.
So you see like someone your age doing it. And for like me, it was like the fact that like, I forgot what song it was. I want to say it was like either a Hilary Duff song or somebody close to Hilary Duff that they used to play on Z100 all the time. I had this RCA fucking little boombox shit that had like the tape and then the CD player at the top, but it also had the AM FM shit. And I would always just bump Z100. And then like, I was like realizing like they play a lot of young artists on here. And then like, obviously, you know, like time goes on, music videos become a thing. And like at that time I had just moved to Connecticut. So I was like just testing the waters on like what the fuck is going on musically. Like, you know what I'm saying? Cause it's like, in New York, we all listen to the same shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? So it's like
Jersey too.
Exactly. So it's like moving to a place like Connecticut where it's like, you know, the main core station is contemporary rock, and like you can't get Hot 97 out there. You know what I'm saying? They have their own hip hop station that's like kind of like not really up to date as well. So like, you know what I mean? So it's just like I was just trying to like test the waters. But the first person who like, obviously I was a fan of Pharrell, fan of Kanye, fan of everybody, but like the first person that made it like an equal playing field for me was Travis McCoy.
From Gym Class Heroes.
Gym Class Heroes. Like, it was the fact that I was like, oh, this is a black artist. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, kind of, like, doing whatever, and this shit is fire, too. So that kind of, like, gave me the push to, like, oh, maybe one day I'll try music. But, like, you know, eventually it just came.
That's hard. Like, before I forget, Hilary Duff, her Metamorphosis album.
Okay.
I was a big Lizzie McGuire fan, so I I ran that shit into the ground. But yeah, like that album's crazy. And Gym Class Heroes album, their first album, like,
I still listen to like a lot of their shit to this day.
Yeah, see, like I always
I'm about to bust your head. I've been meaning to make this point.
Let's go.
O3 Greedo has a song.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
It's called Substance.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard it?
Yeah, I've heard it.
What song does that flip?
I don't know.
Gym Class Heroes, We Woke Up, Intoxicated Off of All Types of Drugs. It's the same song. It's the same song.
Yeah.
So, in reality, Greedo was a Gym Class Hero fan.
Come on, man.
Greedo was a Gym Class Hero fan, bro. Yeah. And it's so crazy that people really bumped that song, like, on a whole different level than what it was originally made for.
Yeah,
like,
you know what I'm saying, yeah,
bro? Nah, that shit's so crazy, bro.
Yeah, nah. Greedo's been had the sauce.
Yeah.
Like, he's been home for a minute now, but I'm just happy he's, like, out and everything. And, like, the project, I don't know. Like, I just love Greedo. I think he's amazing. And I never would have figured that out until you told me.
Nah, no bullshit. I, like, my mans was, like, playing it, like, around the time of Draco died, and I was like, what? And he's like, you never heard this? This is Greedo. I was like, nah, this is Gym Class Heroes, and I paid it. And he was like,
damn. What the fuck? you got me with that one. Shit. Before we move on to other shit, Lee, what about you? When did music like become a thing you fuck with a lot?
Just like Dorian said, when he stole my story.
Hey, bro, I can't have a sister, bro. Like,
my sister,
yeah,
was the one that used to want to do music and shit, but she was listening to pop music, Katy Perry, you know, Sam Smith, I think that's his name, and shit like that. You know what I'm saying? And we used to watch playing like Disney Channel and all that shit, like China and McClane and all that shit, that Dynamite shit. Mm-hmm. All that shit. That's what I really used to just listen to, because she just played that shit over. But I'm like, probably like in third, fourth grade. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Probably second. And shit. And then we move to the East. That's when I start listening to like Lil Wayne more and shit. Then start Cheek Keep coming out. Yeah. All that shit. And it's like, oh yeah, I'm a nigga like him. Just going that crazy. I used to be the biggest Cheeky fan. That's crazy.
What was your favorite tape?
Shit.
What was your favorite song?
My favorite tape was the Finally Rich. The one where he was, I don't fucking know the name.
Doesn't he have one named Finally Rich?
He does. That was his first album.
But it's not the first one I'm talking about. The one that he got the one song.
Like, Back from the Dead?
Back from the Dead's great too, but.
No, bro, I think it's like, if I pull up the thing right now, I'll show
Bang.
You.
Bang.
They got that one song in it.
Almighty Soul 2.
He flipped Stunned Like My Daddy. It was that tape. You know what I'm talking about.
Is it? I can't remember, but I know what you're talking about, though.
Hell yeah, I used to stay bumping, dude.
And before I forget, you and your family are originally from Nigeria.
No.
No. My fault?
Kenya.
I'm sorry. That's what I meant.
I think my mom and dad are from like Somalia and shit.
I'm so sorry. That's what I meant. I meant Kenya. But yeah, so like when did y'all first move to the States?
Like 2003.
Okay. How old were you?
We moved here 2004. I was 3 years old.
Got you. Okay. So yeah, you know, like, yeah. So like you were, you know, you kind of moved here pretty young. So you know, you just kind of
you
were 3 in 2004.
Yeah.
What year were you born?
2001.
No, I'm joking. No, I'm playing. I'm playing. I wasn't far behind.
Oh, he looks mortified.
I was born on 06.
Yeah. Oh, shit. No,
I'm playing, bro.
That's going to be so funny.
Oh, he getting there, man.
I'm getting there. I'm getting there. Born on 06, man. 06, baby.
Nah, man. I get it. I never had that conversation with myself because I've been an uncle my whole life. Like technically, like I have like a nephew who's my age.
What?
Because my sister's 20 years older than me. My big sister's 20 years older than me, so she had kids.
Okay, yeah.
So like we just like
you're like black family.
Nigga, my best sister sold out.
How many siblings you have?
I got three. Wow. No, my fault. I got two. I got a big sister and a younger sister. Mm-hmm. Big sister by a different mother. Younger sister, same mother.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I love you, Aisha and Joe. Shout out to Aisha and Joe. I love them. Yeah, for real. But yeah, so like as y'all, you know, like music happens, movies happen, y'all start forming your own perspectives and just like life view and shit. When did all of y'all know that music was going to become more than just a hobby for you? Like, when did you know it was going to go from like, oh, I like this to like, I'm making this, like, I'm going to make a go of it type shit?
My thing was, I felt like I wasn't really interested in much other things. I felt like I didn't really have any other hobbies, and I was like, this is something that I'm really, really good at. And like, at a point, I was like, I don't even want to like get a job. Like, I just want to do this. Like, I want to make this the job. Right. So after I found myself improving even more and more, I was like, okay, this is like actually something that I can do and make like my job actually. So I think that's when I felt like it was, like I could get really serious with it.
And how old were you?
I was probably like, it's probably like 2021 or 2022. So like, it's probably 15.
Okay.
15, 14 maybe.
Yeah. And like, I know you just started like, you just hit the ground running.
Nah, yeah, bro. It's been so crazy. Like, it's been insane.
Yeah, yeah, man. I want to dig into that a little bit more, but mm-hmm. I want to hear from these two. Sure. Lee, when did you know like music was going to be like the thing you wanted to do? Cuz I know you were also like dabbling in comedy at the time too. So like, when did the music really start to become like, I want to do this shit?
I feel like it's like I always wanted to do music type shit, but mm-hmm. like every time I try to do something else, it'll be like I always get brought back to music. Like I would say one time, I was at juvie and shit, mm-hmm. and now you know you in there, you got nothing to do. But the only thing I did was just write music and shit, and I was sending letters to my girl and shit, talking about some. When I get out, one day I'm gonna be a big rapper. Just watch, my baby. It's just like, I don't know.
Now you AyooLii, bro.
Yeah, hey man,
now you AyooLii.
I was telling her that shit. I was 16. I was 16 years old.
Damn.
And she writing her letters and shit. And I'm good now though.
Wow. And yeah, nah, like once again, you know, like mm-hmm. you know, like Dorian, like you just hit the ground running, like
you know
you put out hella shit, you made like a crazy impression. Like my brother Alphonse over at Pitchfork put me
shout out, out. Yeah. Shout out Alphonse.
Yeah, nah, for shout real out. Like sure. yeah that's every boy. Fucking time, bro.
Shout out,
yeah, nah, I mean like most, like I haven't mentioned it on the pod. I was telling them before, I left Pitchfork. I'm not there no more. I'm going somewhere else. I'm gonna fill y'all in. I'm gonna fill everyone listening in later. But yeah, like I wanted to just like publicly say like that's like my man. Like he was so welcoming. Like he's the best, man. I love fucking Alphonse.
His knowledge of music is crazy.
Yeah, he's like I don't know where he finds the time. I mean, it's his literal job, but like he's a machine with it.
That nigga was writing about me.
Yeah,
he's so tapped in.
Before anybody even really fucked up on my shit like that.
Yeah, nah, like you, he put me on to you. He might even put me on to y'all, to be completely honest. Man, you know,
see,
like
he's really tapped in. He's the
go. Yeah, man. Like it's
not tongue either. Like
he's very honest.
I appreciate
too, yeah.
that.
Yeah,
he's not gonna be biased. Like he's just gonna give you a great musical.
Good, yeah, bro. You know, like he's just yeah, no, like he stays 10 toes. Yeah, that's that. Yeah, no, I like just wanted to say that's my brother. Shout out Alphonse for real. So, Polo, what about you, bro? When did you know music was gonna become more than just a hobby?
Around like beginning high school time,
mm-hmm.
Around the time I had moved back to New York, and like I don't know,
hey, yo.
I used to just make music off laptop and hey, like, Xbox.
Hold headset. Up, this was like in 1944.
Yo.
He's giving us them old stories.
1944.
So it was like I even recorded off like this HP laptop and the Xbox headset. But like I remember like the first time like showing people my music. I was like in school and computer class and shit, and it would be like these like a couple girls that like, you know, like that'd be like the social girls. That's like, you know, cool with everybody, you know what I mean? Not mm-hmm. no stuck up shorties, anything like that. But I was like comfortable enough. I was like, yo, I want to show you my music. And I showed her my music. And she was like, you sound white. And I was like, all right, well, at least I'm doing something different. I can probably make some money off this shit. And I just took it serious then, but not so serious. And then in like 2018, that was like my first time. 2017, 2018, that was like my first time doing a whole like going through label offices and stuff like that. But not for myself, for a different artist, but like, you know, actually seeing how shit is.
Mm-hmm.
Shit's a cakewalk.
Yeah, that's crazy, because this is my first time seeing all this shit.
Yeah.
And I didn't even see shit yet.
Right. Yeah.
This is my first time seeing shit.
Yeah, because I mean, yeah, you know, like, that's a great point, because, like, this is, like, you know, like, y'all are going on, like, a full-blown press run. Like, I know, yeah. Like, I know, bro, y'all are talking to later. Shout out to my man, Olivier. But, like, he's amazing. But, like, but yeah, how's this press run been, man? Like, y'all have, like, really been traveling all over for it.
I mean, I'm personally, I'm happy that I'm doing this with these guys right here.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so insane.
Yeah.
Yeah, not because, like,
crazy.
To be real with you, this is stop number one.
Right. Yeah, yeah, no. So it's like,
I mean, how I'm going to feel about it at the end of this shit? I mean, hey, as long as I'm on a flight home, you know what I'm saying?
That's real. That's my dog. Home.
Yeah, but I literally miss my house. Like,
I get it, man.
I think all my packages are getting stolen right now.
Yo, I'm not even there to get them right now.
Yeah, he just picks up my packages when I'm on the road. So it's like, if he's not there, like, ah, oh, fuck.
But yeah, nah, like, this being, you know, you like, I only ask that because, you know, like, you just graduated high school. Mm-hmm. Like, you're coming here from Milwaukee. Mm-hmm. You know, like, this is like, y'all are like doing like the New York press run. Like, you know, like,
this is literally my first time. And I, bro, if you had told me that this was gonna happen even like a year ago, I'd be like, you're lying.
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't be in New York right now, like, doing like press and stuff, like, even on this podcast. Like,
now, you know what's so crazy? Like, crazy. That's bad, because we had a conversation about like how things would go, like,
if, but like, it's still shocking
because, like, we weren't sure if this, like, yeah, exactly. This project has been like in the, like, Mono had did the interview damn near almost like a year ago, like, right. You know what I'm saying? It was like probably about to be fall time when he had shot the interview,
right? And shout out to Mono too.
No,
shout
out to Mono,
and Millen,
Nobel,
yeah,
and it literally was like, the album had already been in hold for about, say, 6 months, around like 6 months, probably 5 months around that time.
Right, right.
And like, so like, it was a lot of things that like I would like have conversations with him on, like, you know, like, because he would ask questions and like, but like, we didn't really think it was like
seeing it play out,
yeah,
in real life.
Yeah,
like,
it's crazy.
Like, it's insane.
Actually.
Yeah, nah, like, it's you know, like, it's different when you got, like, the publicist behind you. Shout out to Dark PR,
yeah,
and Isaac,
yeah,
and Sam and Scott and all of them, and like, y'all like got like stops and shit.
Not
you
yet.
Know, like, it's like, you know, like, that's a different type time, you
not
know,
yet.
And like,
nah,
every
for real.
Having a schedule is like,
right,
like, nuts,
nah,
like,
for real.
Like, my first time doing like any of this, I just can't believe it.
Yeah, like,
and even with like doing it with them is like even crazier, like,
right.
I think it's like funny because it's like, well, me and you, we already did our run, like, you know what,
yeah,
I'm saying? So
yeah,
it's
no.
Like, now doing it again, like, it's like, I'm like more so like, you know, for like, for anybody who has questions, I want to know how it is doing like a PR run or like going on, like, you know, where you have to do like editorials and stuff like that. Like, don't be scared of it. Like, it literally is like something that y'all should do.
I'm not gonna lie,
do.
I was mad nervous.
No, yeah, it's something
mad
that y'all should do. Like, people wouldn't ask to do it if they weren't interested. Like, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
And that's all I have to say.
Yeah, nah, like, yeah, no, like, just to follow up on that, for anybody who doesn't know, me and Polo did this for the Fader, what, like a year ago?
Yeah, a year
just
ago.
About?
Like,
yeah.
This was like, and it's crazy because I think it was like, you were like the first person before Mono who had got like insight or anything on what was going on with me and me, or like what was coming next and stuff like that. And I remember like the last question you had asked, like, so what's the big next? And like, me and my manager was just like, bro, like, it's a lot of things we gotta like solidify, but one thing we're gonna solidify is that this is our sound, like, you know what I mean?
Right.
And like,
yeah.
And I remember like just like stamping, like, you know, there's a lot of things that like that's going on today, a lot of things that like musically, and like not even just musically, but like other ways that like, yeah, like I have a strong influence on, or like, you feel me, like I'm not gonna say I started because someone has always done something beforehand, but I have a strong influence on it. Then like, not only that, but in this world you could you can get a beat down the street.
Yeah, for real. That's
10 minutes from me.
Too real, not man. Really.
Somebody think they too good, go get a beat down the street.
Bro. Like, nah, man. My dad makes beats, so I get it. Like, you know, like everybody, you know, like it's. Like it's you know, like you know what you want. Like that's one thing I've always appreciated about you. You know what you want.
Nah, thank you, man.
You know what you want. You know how you want it to sound. You know how I want it to be. You know how it wants to be presented. Like when we were at the when we were at the smoke shop for the fader. Like at least three kids walked up to you and were like, "Yo, like your music, like put me like not like put me on
and
a
that
path,
was like,
but, like that
I
was
met
like
for the first time,
right? You know,
we're
like,
just like we're just doing this interview. And it's just like mad people are just so in shock to actually be like. Able to see me, and it's like, you know, like I feel like one, that's a good thing always, yeah. But it's like I want anybody who's listening to my music to just know that you don't gotta act timid about that shit, like,
right?
Something to express, and also you feel me, you feel like another thing, like I said, interview is definitely like one of like strong. I still have your lighter, by the way.
What was I ask you about that shit? That's so funny.
Anybody got an iPhone charger?
Yeah, nah. I was gonna ask you about that because I saw a lighter over here. I was like, you probably still have my lighter.
I definitely still got your lighter. It's crazy. I keep it in the shoes that I don't wear, so nobody loses it, nobody touches it. Nah, but yeah, Mono left some shit at my crib too. Somewhere when I do all these sit downs, like someone will leave something, and I'm just like, all
right. That's hilarious. Oh my god. Before we move on to the project, I can't not ask you about your self-titled that you just put out.
Yeah.
That it's great. You know, like congratulations. You. You know, like thank you
for writing about it, bro. Nah, I gotta say thank you. Yo, dime me up.
Nah, come on, bro. I saw you put it out, and I was like, I need to like when I was over there, I would like it was a combination of like being assigned things and me pitching things. I was like, I'm writing about this. Right. I listened to it. I was like, yeah, I need to do this.
Yeah, I really, really you know, do appreciate
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it was. It's a great project. Really thank cool debut. Much. And but like, I just wanted to. You know, like you've been producing for people for years, like obviously these two right here and like a bunch of other people. Like, of course, like we were talking about it off camera, like you were on the Richie project.
Yep.
Richie project's great. But like, when did you, you know, like when, like, why was now the time to drop the statement piece debut project for you?
Yeah. So, I mean, I've done like a couple vocal songs before that, but it was like kind of more on a fun type.
Somebody
pass
me one of those waters.
But I had got a deal, and I was like, they were like, okay, we want you to do these projects. And I was like, okay, like, I feel like we're also in a very weird time with music, especially in my generation. Mm-hmm. So like, the kids that's like close to my age, and I was like, dang, like maybe I should like actually sit down and do something serious and like actually made a full project. Cause I had songs scattered around that like, I never really like. The thought to make a full project was always in the back of my head, but I never like sat down and it was like, I'm gonna execute this and actually do it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like that happened, and around the time I was like, okay, like now I actually have an incentive to like make a full project. I have things to say. I always thought like, because like before I was making beats, I wanted to be a rapper, but I made a song that was pretty bad. But so I was like, I'm gonna do producing, but I always told myself, like, I want to, like, master one thing before I move on to the other thing.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I was in a very, very, like, comfortable place with, like, production. So I'm like, I can actually give this a try with another skill on my belt. You know what I mean? So I think it was just that time, like, it's that time to make it sit down and actually do it.
That's tight. Yeah, because, like, I mean, like, you've always been pretty versatile. But, like, seeing the range on the project, like the one, it's near the end. I'm already run dry.
Run
like cause originally I think Raining in Brooklyn was my favorite at first, mm-hmm. but you know, just like Run Dry is like that's like some like synthy new wave shit.
Yeah.
You know, like you got like the rock sampling stuff. You got like there's like so many different kinds of like Feardorian beats out here.
Yeah,
and it's like a sampler. You
know,
yeah,
like, literally, it was Cause like a lot of those, like it's funny that you say Rainer in Brooklyn. Cause like I was out here when I made Run Dry and when I made Raining in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. It was like two very different times. But like, I was just walking in a thrift store one day, and the sample for Run Dry was playing. I'm like, yo, who's on aux? Like, they're going crazy. So I'm like asking the dude that's like the at the register. Cashier. I'm like, who's that? What?
I was saying cashier.
Yeah, the cashier. I was like, yo, like, what's this song? They're like, oh, it's this song called it's called Is It Dry?
Yeah.
The original song is It Dry by Project Pablo or Patrick Holland. Now, shout out Patrick. He cleared the sample. Shout out my dog. But yeah, I was like, whoa, this song is crazy. I had to fly home the next day. I made the beat in the airport. That's why I was like, the song I was like, just got the plane, got jet lag or whatever.
Right.
And I was like, dang, like, this one is crazy. I was in the car with my homie Blake the Man. Shout out Blake the Man.
Shout out.
He had a show because he's on tour with Between Friends in Atlanta. And I was just like showing him very, 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 very early versions of the album. And Run Dry was a song I had made. And he's like, yo, who'd you sample for this? I'm like, this dude named Project Pablo. He's like, yo, I know him. Like, I'll like show him the song. So it's just like, it's just crazy how things happen. Like,
right.
The project is very real. It's like very like, it's about real life experiences. Like, if I never would have walked into that thrift store, that song wouldn't have been made.
Right.
Like, I wouldn't have found the song. It's just, like, super, like, crazy, like, real-life experiences on that. Right. Raining in Brooklyn, it was actually raining in Brooklyn. I was, like, stuck in that. You remember when it was, like, flooding?
Yeah.
All the trains were shut down.
Yeah,
I was
here. And the shit was, yeah, no, yes, like,
I didn't have, I couldn't leave the crib. So I was, like, I'm gonna just make that song. So it's just, like, I don't know, like, it's just really real life.
Right.
On that project, for sure.
Yeah, you know, yeah, no, yeah, no, like, you're just, like, you know, like, it's very, you know, like, you're just talking about, like, being at parties and being, like, disembodied. Like,
not
that's,
literally.
Like, that's, like, that was one of the things that first caught me when I was, like, first listening. Mm-hmm. I was just, like, I don't know, just, like, your writing was, like, super duper direct.
Right.
And, you know, like, it just blended well with the beats, and it yeah. sounded great.
Thank you
know?
Very much. Yeah, yeah, it was, the themes of, like, being at a party and being, like, because, like, when I was younger, I was very outgoing. But right, then, right, like, right. I became, like, more, like, introverted in a way. So, like, I'd be at parties and I'd literally, like, be, like, dissociating at, like, points because it's just, like, I don't know. It's, like, sometimes I'd just be feeling like that.
It's
but,
not
like,
sure.
Yeah. Not.
Chill.
No,
he's different.
I don't know. I just.
He's different.
Sometimes I'd be feeling weird in, like, social places. But I don't know. I tried to, like. I tried to use that album as a diary because it was a lot of things I wasn't really able to say.
Right.
So I just used that as like diary therapy, yeah. really.
That's a pretty bold thing to do for like your first like proper project.
Yeah.
So I was just, you know, like, I was just kind of blown by
that's
that.
That's another reason why I just named it like after me because like, right. this is me. Like, this is who I am. This is what I deal with. This is things I experience every day.
Easy.
Yeah.
So, you know, like this, I know A Dog's Chance has been, also I didn't say it before, A Dog's Chance out right now, go listen, please run it up, but like,
please,
this,
bro.
Please, yo, but this shit's been done, y'all said it's been done for like a good minute, so yeah. I mean, like, once again, like, Lee and Dorian, like, y'all already had a relationship, you'd made several songs, but like, when did the three of y'all first come together and decide like it's time to make a project together?
Y'all can say that. Y'all be saying I'm lying.
I personally knew Dorian for like shit, how long?
Like 2018.
Yeah, they knew each other.
We know each other since like 2018.
So long, I guess.
Right.
I was a fan. I was a massive fan.
So like, I've always been tipped with him, and like during the time of my transition point of becoming an independent artist, like, he was one of the first artists, one of the first people I hit up for like beats.
Yeah.
We had like made like
one song. It was literally one
we
song.
We made one song, but I knew like it was in the direction of where it needed
yeah.
to go. So around the time like when I moved to Atlanta and shit, we started locking in. And he was like doing songs with like AyooLii and like, you know, like other kids inside like this, like at this time, like, you know what I mean, that's in this way, like in the same sound lane.
Yeah.
And fuck yeah, this old big back over here, man, he had fucking took the skate park beat first. Somehow, some way,
the way I did it though is because Dorian has sent me that beat. I wasn't going to use it
right.
until Renzo came, and I thought opportunity. He came with
he said, oh,
it was like 3, 4, 5, like boys in my apartment, bro. I've never seen these kids. They came to give Maz a feature for $50. I said, Maz, give these niggas their money back, nigga. Yo. I said, fuck what y'all was finna do. Get on this beat. We did all that shit in one night.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I made the skate park beat as a joke, too.
I have
a friend named Envy.
What?
And he had dropped the album, and there's a song called Crash and Burn on it. And I was like, you know what? I told him, I was like, yo, bro, I'm going to make this a Milwaukee beat for fun, and I'm just going to send it. I'm going to send it off. I'm going to see what happens. And then right. Skate park came, and I was like, whoa.
Like, nah, but it's so crazy, because, like, I'm in L.A., I'm filming Allendale Drive.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm like, it's like the last day, like, probably like the last, like, couple hours of the B&B before I hop on the plane. Like, so the whole entire weekend, I'm like, going through the pack of beats, and I'm like, yo, this shit's so hard. And then I'm like, hold on really quick. Because at the time, I'm like, all right, he's working with AyooLii. Like, I'm already fond of who AyooLii is, everything. I'm like,
right,
working with AyooLii. So I go to AyooLii's page. There's nothing with that beat on it. I kid you not. It's like the night before, Lee did nothing with that beat. That beat was not touched.
I didn't even think he was going
to
use it.
Yo, I'm trying to tell you, this is how close this shit was. I was so tired the night before, I couldn't rap it on. We was shooting Allendale Drive from 6:30 a.m., woke up at 5 a.m., 6:30 a.m. shooting from the morning up to sundown. Like, so I was like, I was too beat. And then I was like, I'll just do the beat in the morning. But on the way back from Allendale Drive, I forgot what it was. I was playing like a couple beats I was playing. And then, like, that morning, I woke up, I go to record on a skate park beat.
Yeah.
New God came with a long clip. And then I listened to him, like, nah, this shit snapped. So I was just like, dude, look at AyooLii page again. I looked at his page, bro. And there it is, fresh and hot on the top of his beat. The same fucking beat. And I'm just like,
seven people on it.
I'm like, seven niggas on it, bro. So it's like, I gotta go get all of them for this beat. Like, I'm like, yo, I hit Dorian up automatically. My nigga, why the fuck would you
ever send me? I was like, yo, bro, not bad. Not bad. I ain't think he's gonna use it.
I was like, why the fuck would you ever send me a beat somebody else is gonna get up? I'm like, bro, like, the song I made is so hard, bro. You got me tight. Like, I'm like, I'm going to switch it. So, Boy Band, the lyrics of Boy Band, is the original lyrics of Skate Park.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Because I used the beat. Yeah, same BPM and everything.
Okay.
I just swapped the beat out. So, I was like, I'm not going to use the beat because I know these niggas use the beat. And I told Dorian, I was like, yo, I'm going to send you Boy Band, but put me in contact with AyooLii. I need that beat. Like, I need permission to get on that beat. I need full guarantee to get on that beat. This nigga over here tried to charge me for a feature. This was
listen, look, on my behalf, I was fucked up and I didn't come out and charge him. It was like, I was talking to
who's that?
I was talking to Dorian. Yeah. He said Polo wanted to work with me, right? And I was like, who's that?
Yo, not a screenshot.
I got a screenshot. We got a screenshot of the message. I'm like, who's that?
You know what's crazy? No, wait. Yeah, find that screenshot because I also have a screenshot.
We're pulling up receipts on you, bro.
Oh, that's funny as hell. Damn. This is the one time I wish we were filming this shit. That's so funny.
I had the receipts of when I hit you up and I was like, bro, you got me tight as fuck. I literally was just looking at it the other day.
Really?
I was like, this is hilarious. And I remember saying, like, bro, why'd you send this beat to them niggas, bro? Like, what the fuck, my nigga?
Bro,
like, I was so mad. I was like, how did you feel like they deserved this beat? I was so tight. I was like, bro, come on. But then it was crazy, though, right? Because I was pissed. PG could probably tell you, though, I was, I became a full fan of everything that was going on. I bumped Skate Park. I probably gave that song the first 500 plays. Dead serious. Like, no bullshit. I played that song back to back. Then, like, once we finally got everything situated, like, I was like, all right, back, cool.
You found it?
I was like, all right, back, cool. Like, I was like, yeah, let's do a song together.
Hey, you gotta send me this, bro.
Yeah,
so I'll show you his music.
Yeah, that's bro. So crazy. Yeah, somebody gotta send that to me too.
I posted on Twitter. I was like, this was the crazy, start of something.
Nah,
this was the start of something.
It's so funny.
Oh my baby.
My bad.
Son.
But it's like, I don't know. I feel like, and that, like, in that like quick brief time, like I knew like, all right, we all have to do something. So right. Like, once it was like, all right, let me use the skate park beat, and I was like, I'm gonna send you something. And like we was like already working, and we already, what song did we do first? We did Boy Band first, obviously, and we had like another song that we had did in between.
Yeah, it was some shit. It was shitty. The vocals.
It was like some other songs that.
It was when my mic was fucking.
It was some other songs that had came out in between. But like during that time,
it was like Hot One.
I was during that time I was listening to. I went through like a really bad depression, and I was like, I gotta find the best shit to sample. Like literally going pan. Like I did not talk to my girl for like 2 days, 3 days. Like literally, I was like, no, I had to
be the best at the best. Though,
like, no, I can't be played with. I had to find everything. Like, and within that time period, I found the sample to Allendale Drive. I found Ricky Eats Acid. I found, yes. What was the other one we did? Montauk. It was a lot of, all the samples basically that like was like brand new and fresh to me on this project I found within that time. And I was like, yo, let's see if you want to sample this shit. And Mr. Dorian.
Which one are we talking about?
Ricky Tassi.
Okay, so here's the thing. Let me explain. So boom.
Please.
I'm at my desk. Bro. Polo calls me one night. He's like, yo, you need to sample. I didn't really see the vision at first. But I was like, all right.
Mind you, I didn't talk to my girl for 2 days. I'm in my room locked in, listening to samples. I got the best one.
on your Goku
I got one.
No, yeah, I was like, I don't really see the vision, but you know what? I'll do it, right? So I'm getting to working on the beat. Okay, so everything's on beat. Obviously, the sample is a guitar. So, like, when you're playing, they're not making the song to be specifically on beat, if that makes sense. So it's not like... It's not meant to necessarily loop and get sampled.
Right.
So everything is on beat. I'm chopping the sample up, and I'm using the metronome. Everything's on beat, except the end, where it's like, that part was super off beat. Everything else was on beat. So I'm doing surgery on the sample for like 30 minutes. I'm trying to get it to loop properly so it's not like ugly, so the clean isn't like ugly. I mean, the loop isn't like ugly. And I'm like, Polo, at one point I was like, Polo, I can't do it.
He tried to drop call.
Like, no, I'm gonna do it tomorrow, bro.
He tried to explain everything to me. I was like, bro, we're not getting off this phone until the beat is done.
How long had it taken you before he told you that to like try and make it a thing?
It was like how long was I working on the beat?
Yeah, how long you working on the beat?
It had to be like 30 minutes.
No, it was maybe more like, than 30 minutes. Yeah, it was closer like, to like 45 minutes.
Yeah, gotcha. Okay.
So I'm like. So I'm really doing real surgery. Like usually, like when I'm chopping samples, it does not take that long.
Right.
But like, I'm really like confused because like everything's on beat except the last part where it changes, and I'm like, yo, the loop sounds so ugly because like the loop really wasn't ugly. I kept asking Polo, I'm like, am I tripping
or? Nah, it's so crazy because it was ugly for a long period of time, and then like he had did some shit where it was like he cut. So pretty much it goes out towards the end, but there's a piece of it, like a millisecond to 3 milliseconds, that's cut out and moved back so it actually loops on point. It's like where he cut it, dropped the vocal at some point, and then like so it now loops on point.
I was doing real
stuff. But it was like he had to like double layer it and make sure everything's completely lined up. So it was just like it was a lot. But I say like altogether that beat probably took like 1 hour and 30 minutes to make.
Not literally. It usually never takes.
And that was only because he was trying to like not make the beat, and I don't.
Bro was bucking so hard.
I was already going mental about needing a hit.
Yeah. Wow.
I really almost gave up on that beat. I'm not gonna lie. That song almost didn't come. So I was just like, bro, I've been doing my best. I literally felt like I was like a doctor, like doing surgery, bro.
Wow.
I'm cutting it. It's not sounding right. Because even if the loop sounds a little bit off to me, I'll be like, trash. So I'm asking Paul. I'm like, yo, am I tweaking? And it's like, but was super fire after it was done. You said what?
That song was like the song that made it.
Yeah, I think it made it very serious after that.
Right.
Like,
skate park we're talking about, right?
Because we made one song before that.
No. I'm trying to tell you, there was like, there's like, two songs in between. Oh, I know.
What's up?
Brave Little Advocates one, Because the Brave Little Abacus one came first. Mm-hmm. Your Arms Is My Cocoon came first. And then it was Ricky Eat's Acid. That's mm-hmm. Oh, you're talking about,
I'm not tweaking. Okay. I thought you meant songs with Shaw.
Yeah, because I don't know the first two.
Raccoon. But it's crazy, though, because I was like, all right, at the time, I'm telling my manager, like, I need to, you feel me, fuck with these kids. And he's like, bro, try to do something with them. And I'm like, all right, bet. He's like, try to make something with them. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so then, like, we finally get Ricky's Acid done. And, like, when we finally record it, I'm like, all right, this is the song we're going to send to Lee. And I sent it to Lee. Ducked me for 2 days.
You did. You be trying to make me seem shice.
You're not shice, bro. It's like, all of us before this music shit is so hard to like get to sit down, like you know what I'm saying. Like,
yeah.
So like, I had contacted like the two people that I knew that would like see Lee or run into Lee or whatever the fuck. Lee got locked up, so I had to wait for him to come home. When he came home, though, like, he dad called niggas, like, we got on a group FaceTime, you feel me?
Yep.
And we was like, yo, I got the song for you, just do it. He was like, all right, bet. And he got it done. So when he got it done, I was just like, yeah, this is, we're out of here.
Man, like, okay, so, like, now that we're doing, like, track-by-track story time, there's two others I want to know about personally, because, like, they're, like, my two favorite songs on the project. First one is Tony Snell. Ooh. And I'm going to tell you why.
You say you like it?
I like that song a ton, bro.
Honestly, you fuck, I tell you.
First off, you were going crazy on it. Second off, Anamana Gucci sample, there Scott Pilgrim there soundtrack.
There we go.
Scott Pilgrim,
you know, that's come on, bro. That's my shit, son.
So I had an Xbox 360, right?
Yeah.
And they have in the shop item. It's like, here's some demo games.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the full thing. But we'll let you get a little snippet of the game, right?
Yeah.
So I'm trying to find games for it. And the Scott Pilgrim versus the World game pops up.
I got that shit on my Switch in my backpack
it's
right
so
now.
It's so fire. It's so fire, right? It's so fire. Yeah. So, like, I get the game, I'm playing it. And the first level has the song Another Winter. And that's the farthest I could go.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
yeah. It's one level, wow. And I can't get any other levels. So the song, this is the only song that I would hear.
That's why the beat name was Another Winter.
Yeah, that's why the song on the soundtrack is actually called Another Winter.
Yeah.
Hell, but it's just Another Winter.
Yeah, exactly. it's a reference to the actual song. So a lot of my beats are like built off, whether it be like nostalgia I feel like other people would get, or it's nostalgia from like, just me personally, yeah. So that's why I made that beat.
I'm loving them. He's sending me best beats.
It was like, I was like, yeah, like, this really, like, reminds me of my childhood, bro. Because I couldn't hear any other song on the game.
Because you couldn't get past the level.
I couldn't get past the first level.
That's a lose.
So that's why I sampled that. So, like, when we, like, dropped it and we, like, put out the music video, it was, like, super crazy to see them, like, retweet it. Cause I was like, bro, y'all don't even know the half, bro. Like, y'all don't even know the half. It was super fire.
That's crazy. No, I've been an Anamana Gucci fan like since like right before then, and like they came to my college and like played a show.
That's crazy.
That's maybe one of like the scariest. Like, I almost died in that pit. That shit was fucking crazy.
They be turnt.
Yeah. Be turnt. Yeah, no, them pasty white nerds be going crazy for that Anamana Gucci shit, bro. I swear to God. But Lee, talk to me about rapping on that beat. Cause you know, like, of course, like that's like some low end shit. But like,
what song?
Tony Snow.
Oh, yeah. I think the whole screaming in the beginning really, I tried to do what Polo was doing, cause he used to just do. I think I was around him and he was just screaming.
Right.
I have a lot of Scram's tracks with Dorian where I'm like, it's a lot of screamo involved. And
right,
nobody
right.
has heard yet.
Okay.
That's a different.
But I'm like, how the fuck he do it? Like, right? That should be hard as a bitch.
Yeah.
But that's why mine's, I have to chop it up. I did like three layers.
Yeah.
And shit. So I was screaming and shit, and I just put the verse in.
That was like,
I tried to have him hop on it, but he wasn't fucking with it.
Yeah.
It was crazy, nobody told me to get on that song. I came to the crib because at the time, like,
it was that week we was working on.
Yeah, they was at the crib downtown. And I'm like, of what niggas made, and I'm like, I shot a video last night. They're like, yeah, we shot Tony Snell. I'm like, Tony Snell, what is Tony Snell? And then I hear it like a week later at the video, and I'm like, who recorded this? I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, yo, no, run this back. And Lee's like, oh, I'll fuck with it. I'm like, bro, like, you, like that. And then everybody was like, nah, we're dropping that song. Like, fuck out of here. Like, you ain't gonna be the only one that get to scream.
Right.
I'm like,
yo, come on now.
Verbatim, you think you're the only one that gets to scream over here? Just like, all right, bro, whatever.
That's
man.
Hilarious.
I was so sick recording that verse too. I was like really sick, and I was like one of the first times like I had used autotune.
Right.
So like, cause like when I was rapping before that, like I just didn't use autotune. Like I had like a couple songs out, but like, yeah, that song put me in a different bag as well. It was really fun making that one.
Yeah.
I was like super sick. We shot it in like the parking lot of where we was at.
Uh-huh.
Super fun day.
That's after that, that was Buckhead, wasn't it? Yeah. That shit was fire.
It's crazy.
That's why I made Uncle Sam, I think.
You
know, oh, word?
Yeah. Same place.
Sam. Same place.
Uncle
yeah.
Sam, be nice to me. Paper planes.
I made plenty shit.
The cute video was shot there.
Cute video was shot there, and paper planes was made there, and fucking...
Pinky was made there.
We gotta shoot a vid. Fire at vid paper play.
Yeah, that's what that one's gotta be crazy. What else was made there? Backpack was made there.
Yeah, backpack, no play,
go up,
yeah.
What else was made there? I feel like I'm missing one.
I think that's it. Let me see them best real quick.
Is that it?
No. Best.
We need these Aztecs lens.
No, not the lens.
No, them Aztecs right there.
Is this not a bus?
I don't think so, because that's a little RB shit, right? But look, because if it was, these vintage was, right? But these cost more than that. That's just like $1,000. This is like $3,400.
They're having the glasses off right now. Y'all can't see it. Like,
that one right there, I don't think, because you know,
some other shit.
I ain't trying to really say that too much. It's like, but it's real, though. I went to Towers and shit. I said, check it out. They said that shit legit. So that's why, you know what I'm saying? It's good.
Those are clean.
I know it ain't buffs. It look like buffs. That's what niggas are trying to do. Yeah. But hey. These motherfuckers.
Yeah, bro. and they match the hoodie too. Yeah, I see it.
Real.
I see it. But before we get too far off track, tell me about Breach World, because Breach World is my other favorite song out here.
It's another beat I tried to escape.
Come on,
not
bro.
We in a Polo Perks sweatshop.
I want to say this before he says the story. It's not because I did not like the sample.
It's fully because this kid is really like, he just stops. bro, like, so like we've been in lockdown. So this is like their first Atlanta trip, like coming from Milwaukee down to Atlanta and shit like that.
Yeah.
I got them this crib like on the south side of Atlanta, like it's like fucking 8 bedrooms and shit like that. Like, so they're like, Lee's living different. No, everybody's living different on this in this crib. But like we're burning ourselves out. It's right before tour.
Yeah.
When I go on with Glaive.
Yeah,
and,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
And Dorian's like, he's supposed to be DJ, so like he's busting his ass like daily, like
so stressed,
producing, man. Rapping, DJing, producing, rap, like training himself, and like he just gets mad tired on the last day. Everybody leaves the crib. He's packing up. I'm like, bro, I just got here. What are you doing? He's like, oh, bro, I can make a beat when I get home. I'm like, nah. We're not doing this. Cause I had just called the Uber there. I didn't drive there, and it's like everybody had dipped. I'm like, all right, bet, whatever. I gotta make sure the crib is for me done. So fucking. I'm like, bro, just like make a beat. So he's going through. He's like, bro, I don't even know what to say. I think I'm sampled out, bro. He goes, so he's going to Spotify. I don't know.
It was a Midwest. It was probably just a Midwest emo playlist.
It was a Midwest emo playlist. Going to Spotify. And then like I just hear, and then he goes to the next one. Cause I'll say, yo, run that back really quick. He goes back. He was like, oh yeah, nah, this is hard. I could do this one. I was like, yeah, bet. He was like, yeah, all right, so bet. I'm gonna do it when I get home. You hear him close the laptop. And I'm like, yo, bro. Stop playing with me, bro. I was like, bro, open that laptop right now and do the beat. He's like, bro, my mom's 2 minutes away. I was like, I bet, bro, no problem, my nigga. Like, you can make that beat in 2 minutes. I done seen you do it. Like, come on, let's go.
Yeah.
He's like, bro, oh my God. Like, come on. His mom gets there. So now he's like, all right, bro, my mom's he's like halfway through being like, bro, just throw the drums on it. Come on. And then like he throws the drums on it, and I automatically stands. I'm like, all right, bet, we good. We can leave. Go home and record on that shit. Then like It's so crazy because I lost the song for a little bit. I recorded the song and then lost the song and then I found it.
When did you record the song? Like how?
That night. I recorded the song that night when I got back to the crib. But I had lost the song because I'm just a sloppy person and I record myself. And then when I found it, I was like, damn, this is actually hard. Like, OD hard. But what's so crazy is that I only found the song because I'm like in my crib one night smoking a fat ass wax blunt. And bro, I'm telling you, like, I'm like geeking so hard that I'm like, all right, let me just watch a skate video. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. I'll go to sleep. Huff type just shit. Dropped a skate video at the time. There was like their new skate video. And like the last song to that video is the same sample. It's Texas Is the Reason. And like I panicked. I'm like like choked on my ear and everything. My girl's like, you go. I'm like, yo, this is my song. I'm like so geeked. I'm like, yo, I gotta get up, go in my room. I'm just fine, looking for this shit. I was like, got it, boom, found it, bro. I just played it. I'm like, go look, I told you, like this. I was like, it's like, nah, this shit is crazy. I like, sat up for 2 days like bumping that song, like send it door, and he fucked with it. But it was like, I don't know, I feel like it was a very like spur of the moment thing. Though that was the plan. I feel like Ricky Eats Acid, I had planned. Somewhere Over the Rainbow, I had planned. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? There's a lot of samples on there I had planned. But like Breach World, Carissa's Weird, he snapped on that one. That's like one of my favorite ones. And it's so crazy because I gave him like 3 or 4 Carissa Weird songs to sample. And he was like, nah. Then he just came one day like, you ever heard this one? Like,
nah, because like when I like find a new artist that like, even if I sample one song, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna make sure I cover all the tracks. I'm gonna
deep dive
in the discography to make sure I'm not missing nothing.
Right.
That could potentially be crazy. And Carissa's Weird was one of them. So I was like, I see the vision. I just haven't found a song yet. And then I found the song that we sampled for Carissa's Weird, and I was like, yeah, this one's crazy.
Sure. It's so funny you bring that up like that, because my homegirl Julianne, like I sent her this album. I was like, this shit is tight, you should listen to it. And she was like, Carissa's Weird, like how the fuck do they know who this is, you know? Like, she was
nah, it's so like, crazy. That band is like it's a muck bang of two other bands.
That's a deep cut, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah,
it's like Band of Horses and then the females from another different band, I forgot where she's from.
And they were from like Seattle or something. Right, yeah, and like and they were together for like a year or some crazy shit.
We were also looking for a lot of female fronted emo bands. Yeah. Like,
right, makes
that
sense.
Was like the swag we wanted.
That's tight, you know, and like that's great for like 3 different reasons.
Yeah,
it's like just trying to shout out to that. Shout
out to Carissa's Weird for real.
Yeah, honestly, I mean, like y'all also kind of put me on a little bit, mm-hmm. So I'm like
fire.
Ready to.
They are fire.
I'm ready to go do that deep dive.
Not for real.
And like. And you know,
Let me know if you find the sample.
I promise.
I will say that it's not in the beginning of this song, mm-hmm. So you like might have to listen for a little bit.
All right.
Yeah. Little clue. I like. I'm not gonna. Sometimes no, because at the show, someone came up to me.
Yeah.
And they were like, "Yo, let me ask you a question, bro." They're like, "What's the sample for Carissa's Weird?" All I said was, "Bro, the name is a hint." And I just walked away. I was like, bro, the name is a hit. Because I want people to like do their own research in there. When they find it, they're like,
I'm doing research right now.
They're like, this is the song. Like, I don't like to tell them outright. I like
to do a little more research.
Yeah. Because like, by me just giving you like even the artist, like you might find something you like just by discovering like the discography and stuff.
Yeah, so exactly. Like,
it's that's just like stuff like that, yeah.
Yeah, right. That's always been the appeal.
Because telling them just right, like outright, is just like, I don't know.
Yeah, nah. Like, that's like that, you know, that's like half the appeal of sampling right there. It's like doing the treasure hunt.
What's even more funny is that like, I guess like, other producers don't think that like we go deep into it.
They get so deep.
So like we'll pick one. That's just the best one out of them.
Right.
Like, we done tried to sample about 4 or 5 of them. So like when other people go ahead and do it and try to like. Copy the sound, copy the aesthetic, copy the wave, copy the swag. It's like, we already did that. Like, we could, like, it's a little bit times, like, when people go ahead and try to make a beat, it's like, yeah. And I'll be like, yo, Dorian, pull it up, like, if we already done
pull
did
up.
It.
It's already the same exact job.
Same exact job, everything. You're literally just copying them. Like, it's just too much. Like, I mean, but I fuck with it, though. It shows that we're making people get invested into the sound as much as we are.
Yeah, people right. Get inspired. I feel like that's one of the greatest things you can do anyway. So it's like,
yeah, no, nah, that's extra important. He's fucking playing the song right now. Like,
that shit is it. Let me see it.
Wow, I'm wearing a superhero.
Now let me see the cover of the album.
It's just a song. I don't think it's.
I don't. Is that the actual band? I don't think they had any music. Oh yeah, it's not this album. I will tell you what album it is.
It's the ugly.
It's the ugly, the red
best,
one.
Yeah, it's like best ugly or the one with the ugly cars on it.
That's a whole another story.
Yeah. I put so much blood, sweat, and tears into trying to get in contact with the girl from that shit.
That's that song. Yes,
that's
that one.
So like, that's another sample that I dead ass locked myself in my room, didn't talk to my girl for like 10 days, literally disrupted him through school, sleep, everything. Like I literally like I got to a point on like the seventh day I just called him and said, bro. This ain't fair, bro. I was like, I'm going.
This ain't fair.
Like, literally, yeah, like, yeah, I'm having a hard time with this. I'm like, all I need to do is find her, bro. I'm like, feel like I know this person. Like, I'm like going through like you know, like how like there'll be blurbs about certain bands and shit. I'm like,
finding
names and finding Facebooks and finding dead Tumblr accounts, dead Twitter accounts. Yeah, dead, like it's just like what was too much. Like, I could never drop the name of that.
Damn, you know, like. Like
there you go.
That's crazy. That's crazy. Lee, that's crazy.
I gave him the album. I was like, look.
Yeah, see that might have. Yeah, nah, we're keeping that in. Fuck it. that's crazy. But but you know, like another thing I love about this project is that like once again, you know, like a lot of variety. Like we were talking about with your shit before, but like, you know, like it's. I feel like it's something different. I mean, like you're in your comfort zone because like this is all stuff you've done before. Yeah. You know, you're kind of you're just kind of doing your thing. Like, you know, Polo. I don't know that I've ever heard you go in over Lowend before, like not like this. You know, so like there's that, and then like you've done rock sample stuff before,
before I met them. Well, I probably did. Didn't know.
So,
but with them, it's like, right. I know the people.
I'll explain it. So, like, Lee got two homies that, like, produce, that, like, are really, like, really, 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 like, into, like, all of my music.
Yeah.
And so, like I said, if someone can't get the sound to somebody, they're going to be like, hey, you should try to do this. So, like, it's been a couple songs that, what's the one that you did with, Fuck! This kid makes 20 songs a day. I forgot what it is, but it's like one of the ones that's produced by People.
Whoa!
No. What
the fuck?
I'm the only person.
What song is that called? I forgot.
That's T.T. Conahead.
What's the name of that song?
Hand in hand. Is like, you feel me? Like that. It's like. At that time, like, I'm the only person with a Gaga sample. Then, boom.
Right.
Lee's able to do a Gaga sample. So, it's right. It's literally, like, it's so funny because it's, like, I just see it as, like, bro, like, it's just, we're both, like you said, I've never done Lowend at all whatsoever until this project. And then we have, like, you feel me, the same thing, bro. I feel like when we sat down, these are all the things that we wagered out.
Right.
And, like, the one thing I did... put in comparison, it's like the one thing that is comparison to us is that we all have some type of background of a farm or something like that. Like when we first started like doing this project, it's like we all have some type of background of a farm because at the time I spent a little bit of time out of state in Connecticut.
Right.
He's from Atlanta, Lee's from Milwaukee. It was like I was trying to find like what's the most one things that would compare to us. And it's like, all right, even at that, like, do we know like the same like type of jingle songs and like, you know, corny like little 2000 bops and stuff like that? And that's like was things that was like catching. All right, we do. So it's like, all right, this is definitely gonna work.
Yeah, and like, yeah, no, because like I was, like you basically already answered the question, but like I was just gonna ask, like, you know, like the two of you were kind of like going into each other's worlds a little bit this time in a way that you haven't really before. And yeah, like Lee, what was that like for you to kind of, you know, like to just kind of like step into like what the two, because like once again, you know, like Dorian's kind of like the conduit who's like, you know, like connecting the, you know, two of y'all on a musical tip.
What was crazy is like even with the whole thing they had going on. That's what I was like thinking, like, hey. But I'm thinking it's like this is a whole new idea I'm coming up with. These niggas already doing it though, you know what I'm saying?
Hey, so like, you know, like steel sharpen steel, great minds think alike, you know, so like that's why, like, you know,
everything
like,
just made sense as to, because he was just bringing them beats that I really needed. Like these are, it's like this is exactly what I was hoping for, like, type shit.
Right. And yeah, nah, like, and it's weird because there's never a period of time I'm listening to this where it sounds like anybody's awkward over any kind of one beat. Yeah, like, y'all
can hear me having fun on this.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, y'all
is so well together. It's just crazy.
Yeah, like, and you know, like, it feels so natural, you know, like, you know, like, I like, and you're like, it's great you bring up, y'all bring up Skate Park, because, like, that song, like, that shit sounds like a party, damn near, no, you know, really? Like, and it's, but not in, like, the superficial, like, oh, this shit's turnt type of way, it's just, like, y'all feeding off of each other's energy in a way that feels authentic, and, like, yeah, like, I remember when it first dropped, and I was stuck on it for, like, at least a day or two, you know, like, I ran it back a bunch of times. So like it's just cool. It's just cool to see that. It's cool to see that, like, extend over a whole project and just see y'all hold each other down and, like, trust each other and take risks. And, you know, I don't know. Like, it's just like, that shit's cool as hell to me. And it's y'all did great. You know,
thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, no doubt. I got two more questions, and the ones I could think of. So so we're talking about Skate Park. I was originally going to ask about the cover for A Dog's Chance because, like, I love this picture of, like, y'all at an arcade machine, and I want to know that story, but...
He doesn't even know.
Okay, all right. That reaction makes me want to know. Talk to me real quick.
All right, so, like, at the time, like I say, where's, like, me, like, I'm, like, thinking of, like, what's comparisons of, like, background, sceneries, aesthetics that we have, you know, like, things that wouldn't be too far off if, like, you look at us, and that would be like, all right, that's kind of, that's still on point because this project sounds a certain type of way. You're looking at the viewpoint of us from a certain type of way, too, and so we go rent this big-ass crib out in Connecticut, and fucking, it has, like, the big lake in the backyard, like, really, really depressing, like, on some, like, Midwest shit.
We're really in the middle of nowhere.
We're really in the middle of nowhere, like, no bullshit.
Cabin.
Soon as we get out there, we was in New York for, like, 2 days and drove out to CT. Soon as we get out there, it's pouring day after day after day after day.
That was so
crazy. That's why a lot of the press photos and stuff have so much rain, and it's, like, it's like so much rain. It's like we have umbrellas and shit because it's like the day we were supposed to shoot the cover, it started pouring something.
It was down, not, like, even pouring before that.
No, not at all. It was so crazy. Like, it was so crazy. We had to run to Walmart, get umbrellas because we was like, all right, if it don't stop, like, we'll just at least have the umbrellas. And it just didn't stop. All our clothes got soaking wet. All our shoes got soaking wet. So, like, we're like 10 minutes away from, like, Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods.
Oh, so y'all... Okay, I know exactly where y'all were. That's crazy.
We're like 10 minutes away from Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods. And I'm like...
You're in Jersey, basically.
Nah, I'm in Connecticut.
Oh, I'm playing.
I'm all the way there. like Massachusetts. And I'm talking to Jason, like, yo, like, we should go, like, to the casino. Like, that's the only thing that's over here. Like, blah, da, 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 da. Like, I was like, but I'm gonna just ask G. Like, for me, I talk to G. He was like, hey, nigga, we need a cover. He was like, nah, I can't... If you leave there, just know you must leave there with a cover. Like, so figure it out. I was just like, I bet. I was just gonna run it then. We went, and for some odd reason, I decided, I was like, hey, you know, I'm gonna do some shrooms. We did some shrooms. The driver of the car did some shrooms. Dorian was in the car. He was in a separate car. The driver of the car did some shrooms. Fucking, and then I forgot who else. I think PG was on shrooms. You was on shrooms. Pretty much, like, everyone besides, like, the other car people was on shrooms.
Yeah.
And then fucking, like, we get there. I got all the shit in my pocket, and I'm, like, walking around where he gets on. So I'm like, yo, shit. Let me get a bag from Starbucks. I put all my belongings in a bag.
Yo.
So all the film, everything.
All the film, the car keys to the rental. Wow. Everything in one bag. So, like, we're, like, looking for a spot. So we find that specific spot. And we're sitting there just like, it's a whole casino of people. We're just like, do we taste like? literally, just take after take after take, like, literally no money in the slot, just like jamming the slot, like, ta-ding, ta-ding, ta-ding. Right. And then fucking, like, so PG shooting covers, boom, 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 boom. And then we're like, all right, you know what? Let's go to the slots, the roulette table. That was the shot we went there for. Specifically, it was the roulette table. It wasn't even specifically for a slot machine.
Right.
We got D'd up. They weren't trying to let us do photos. I was like, all right, bet, let's go back to the slot machine. And then I realized I lost my bag because I was on shrooms. and it had the car keys and everything else.
There's no keys no more.
We couldn't leave the casino.
Mind you, all the casino looks the same.
Yes, for 5 to 10 seconds, we all had a slight panic, like we're not leaving here. And I'm on shrooms. He's on shrooms. Like everything's just, it was too much. But then he found the bag, like.
Wow, and like. And it's crazy because, like, all of y'all look so, like, if not happy, but, like, you're, like, dead hype that you, like, won, that we won whatever y'all were doing.
And,
like,
you know, the whole, I feel like the thing that's crazy about this tape is, like, everything almost didn't happen.
Not yet.
Dead serious.
Right.
If you look at the meaning of a dog's chance, because that's another thing, too, like, we had, like,
right.
It was a thing where the album was out, the project was together for so long, we didn't even have a name.
Right.
Exactly.
And then, like, we had, like, you feel me, once we was, like, move forward, and we was like, all right, bet, like, we're going to go distro this project. We found who was going to distro it through. And everything was like, all right, what's the name? And, like, it kind of went like a ping pong.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then it was, just like, it was getting more pressure, and it was just like, all right, let's get on a call. We got a call, and it's like, all right, how did everybody feel? Like, you know, from the first time we talked and met to now, like.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, richer. Like, everybody's like, I ain't broke no more. Like, I was like, what's like, what was your chance? Like, you feel me, how you was feeling before? And it's kind of like, Dorian said, you feel me, he was at before. Lee said where he was at before. And then I said where I was at before. Basically, like,
We're all kind of stuck.
Yeah, we were all kind of stuck, and we needed something to, like, that was going to, like, make this shit pivot, like, and
right.
Even me as an artist that's been out here for so long, you know what I'm saying, like, I separated myself from something that was, like, kind of, like, stamped on my skin, like, yeah. You know what I'm saying, so I kind of was, like, losing faith of, like, all right, am I ever going to be seen in a different light as an independent artist, like, you know what I'm saying, so right. It's, like, even then, like, it was, like, we all needed, like, a chance, like, we all literally needed a chance,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I was, like, all right, bet, so let's look up. What was the like main word we was looking up? It was like, we gotta look up words that mean,
like, almost not happening.
Something, man. Yeah.
We had a long list of words, and we basically go through, like, synonyms.
Yeah,
like different synonyms of it.
Yeah.
Like, yo, what's the, we were like, all right, what's the, so how do you feel? It was like, I feel like it was like chance, or I feel like we did it, or it's like this. So then we like go through the list, and then like two to three times I seen a dog's chance. A dog's chance. And it was like, why the fan? I was like, we said we're going through it. It was like, a dog's chance. What else was it?
I'm trying
you to gotta find it.
Do you have that?
This is the conversation. Me, you, and Dorian. And we're going through like a bunch of different names. And then like, we're just like, a dog's chance. I was like, let me look at what this shit means. And then I read it off, and we're just like, facts.
That's it. Like,
fucking facts.
Tight. You know? Yo, yeah, because, like, I mean, like, you know, like, a dog's chance. It's, like, it's you know, like, it's, like, the same thing as, like, a snowflake's chance of hell type shit, you know?
I never
like,
even heard, bro, these are all new sayings to me. I guess when it fits your time in life,
yeah,
you'll hear these things.
Yeah, you know, like, just, like, yeah, it's just all about, like, you know, like, either being on the ropes or just, like, being, like you know, like, underestimated people, like, uh-huh. Oh yeah, you don't think you could do this, and yes, then you just come yes, out, and it's yes. Like, that's it. Like,
this is somebody,
you know,
who
like
always wanted to be a rapper, but got pushed in the light of being a producer, no matter how hard he tried.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, right here.
The lead just came from the trenches.
Let me see this.
Oh yeah, see there it is.
Dauntless, said some shit. Helter-skelter.
Helter-skelter.
Harem.
Scare. Like,
off the hip. Missing since Monday. Last summer was different. Hometown.
We're gonna run that one. No bullshit.
That was crazy.
That was crazy. Yeah.
That shit was different.
Yeah.
Not literally though.
Yo, yeah, nah, but like, you know, like it, you know, like it fits because like all of y'all have been put in boxes. All you know, like people might look at you and think like one thing about all three of y'all, and you know, like y'all really came and you know showed people like your range and like what you can do, and just like once again, like this shit is just fun, you know, like it's like a fun project. It doesn't take itself too seriously, but it's also like that can be such a crutch for people sometimes, where it's just like, oh, like it's just fun, where it's like, oh, like the shit's like just mid or whatever. But like, yeah, right.
Be like, get too high or too drunk at that point in the studio,
right? Like,
not yet.
But like, but being like, y'all made fun music that's like good music that like sounds good and feels good. Yeah. To just, you know, like it's like, you know, like I don't want to like. This is some shit I can imagine just like living with, and like every once in a while, like coming back and be like, oh yeah, like I remember, like I'll remember where I was when I heard, like I can imagine these songs soundtracking, like if not like key moments in my life, at least like stuff that I'll be able to recall, like, oh yeah, I heard this here. Yeah. I heard that there, you know, like it's got that type of, I mean, like I also kind of feel like I understand where y'all are coming from, just like in terms of like references and like. Yeah. I mean, and you're like, we're all black at the end of the day. So there's also that, but like, you know, like
exactly,
you know, like, see, like, come on.
That's how it all really started for real. You ask G.
Come on, man. Yeah. Shout out.
I had to make sure he was.
Shout out. Shout out to G for everything, man. Like, I was surprised he didn't come, honestly.
Gotta get bothered, pissed off, aggravated before we sit here and give y'all the bullshit we give y'all sometimes. You know,
man.
And that's the guy that's always behind every decision we make, and I love him to death.
Yeah, we had to reschedule this. We were gonna do this in Gowanus, and he was like, we gotta do it in Ridgewood.
I had to give him a heads up about it. Like, nah. I only been to Gowanus Pirate once. And I went in there, it was like 20 niggas deep, they all had ski masks on, some was smoking through their ski masks.
Right.
And they was on bullshit until they seen this man walk through. So I was just like, you know what, I ain't finna do it. He got two Perrier's on him, a babe hoodie with
I get it.
We ain't finna do that today.
Nah, I feel it. But shout out to G, you know, like I had to like I would have had to like eat the feed the pet because like it was too close to the time, and like he just sent me the bread, so like thank you G, that was real real classy. I appreciate that. But like, oh man, I feel like this shit could go on for like two more hours, but I don't want to keep y'all. But like last question, if all of y'all lives were movies, what would they be? See, it's crazy that I have to ask this question this way because I've never had three people on this show before. So hey, like,
I'm already a movie.
See, you're the first person to say that. I appreciate you.
Dorian the movie.
That's hilarious. So
it would probably just be named Dorian. Like honestly.
That's and just like, you know, it's like autobiography, like biopic type shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Crazy.
What, you said a movie would explain my life?
Or no.
Like,
or,
if we had to make a movie, or if...
Or all three of us.
No, like, it's a movie that explains, that we've seen in our lifetime.
No, like, it's like, if your life was a, like if a movie was made about you, what would it be about?
If a movie was made about me, sadly, it would be made about... not having a chance, literally not having, like, literally, the same shit about this album. It's like, it would literally be the story of somebody who is a humble band,
always doubted,
you know what I'm saying?
They didn't believe in us.
Yeah, they had to do a couple things to get by in life, you know what I mean? But that wasn't the actual goal on life. It was always to actually make music a thing. Never got an open door from the people he wanted to get an open door from.
Exactly. Big one on that.
But had to learn to accept and value the people that did open doors for him. Exactly. And he did it all with his friends. Mm-hmm. And people that he values the most.
You know what? I'm a say it. I think your life would be a Disney Channel original movie, bro.
Nah.
Like,
that'd be fire. Yeah. If not a Disney Channel movie,
I would want my life to be explained in the sense of a Silver Lining Playbook and like other bullshit that goes on. Because that also is a movie where like people doubted on him, stuff like that. He had to overcome a lot of things that he was once judged on.
Which movie? I'm sorry.
Silver Lining Playbook.
Oh, yeah. 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 Lee, what about you? Close this out. If your life was a movie, what would it be about?
Like, what would it be about? What movie would it be?
Like, what? Yeah, just like what? Like.
Roots.
What would your life be about? Like, I mean, like, if like somebody were to make a movie about your life, like, what would that be? What would it be about? Or you could even just like pick a movie that you like that you think could like describe your life.
Oh shit! I'll say. Basically, what Polo was saying, you know how I was added in and all that shit.
Yeah.
I know that ain't what you wanted to hear, but really, he took the words right out of my mouth. You know what I'm saying?
I think I need to make a better answer.
All right,
about my story.
I think it's got you back.
The part about my life that like my movie would be based around is like living out a dream that your parents didn't really get to live out because you know everything got in the way they had kids.
Real
for me. Because, like, people heard my album. They know, like, how me and my dad is. You feel me? And I just recently spoke to him. And he was just telling me about his life and, like, how, like, why everything happened the way it did. And I learned, like, he wanted to, like, do music. Like, he wanted, like, to be a DJ. Like, he's an electrician, right? But, like, this is, like, something I never knew about him. Like, ever. So it's just, like, crazy, like, seeing that. And he sees me now and I'm actually doing it. So it's just, like, crazy, like, living out like some of your parents' dreams and like, cause it, I don't know. I think that's what I would make my movie about. Honestly,
that's a beautiful answer, and I relate 100%. Cause for bro, sure. My father's the reason I'm into music the way I am. I mean, like both my parents loved music, but like my dad he was a doo-wop singer. He was a roller skater. So like he like lived all like you know like he lived like a crazy life, and you know like there were things that he wanted to do that he didn't necessarily get to do, but like you know just kind of. Like, I wrote a book this year. Mm-hmm. I don't know if y'all heard, but
I did not know that. Congrats, bro.
Thank you. Like I wrote a book. I'm not at a point where we have physicals of the book yet, but I'm at the point where I'm about to be able to give my family and especially my father like a book that I wrote, like a physical, like bound.
That's amazing.
You know, like I'm gonna cry. Like I can feel it happening. Yeah. You know, like right now. So like it's just like. To be at that point where you're either doing something that you feel like your family didn't get the chance to do or like being able to give back to your people, you know, like that's like,
that you're really doing it. Like you're really doing it.
It's like, there's no better feeling on planet Earth, honestly, for anybody. But like, thank y'all for this, man. This shit was amazing. Like I knew this shit was gonna go up, and like this shit went up. You know, like this is our second one, me and Polo's second one, like our first like it's like I appreciate.
It's a great one.
Thank y'all, man. Like I really appreciate you taking the time to come and fuck with me, and just like this is like the third one of these I've done like at a pirate too. Mm-hmm. So yeah, like this is just. Yeah, I love the album. I love all of y'all separately, and I love y'all together. So it's just like.
Appreciate
just thank you.
Appreciate you, bro.
Nah, man, you already know. Like, just go listen to A Dog's Chance. Go outside. It's 95 degrees. Rip your shirt off and pull a power up out of somewhere. Like that's the wild, man. Easy.
Thanks for listening. Shout out to y'all for making it this far, and shout out to all the black people listening too, because y'all really impeccable. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and tell a friend to come through next time. One.